Well, happy new year, everyone. Hopefully all of you are doing well. Welcome to the first lawn care live stream of 2022. My name is Ron Henry, and as always, the show is all about you. It's a lawn care Q&A, so if you have questions about things going on in your lawn now or things that you're planning to do in the spring, you know, any plans or anything along those lines, feel free to drop them in the chat. If you're new here, welcome. The way it works is super simple. You simply drop your questions down in the chat, and I work through them in the order they come in. Sometimes I have the answers, sometimes I don't. But either way, we have a great time talking about lawn care, and it's a great start to 2022. You figure with everything going on in the world today, we need something positive, right? And talking about our lawns is always something cool and fun to do. So let's see who we have in the show tonight. Let's starting out, we have Mark F. Mark F. is up. He says, I've always wanted to be first at something, and here I am, first in line. So there you go, Mark. You are first tonight on the live stream, for sure. And you never know. You know, we do giveaways. We try to do giveaways regularly throughout the season. So if you just keep showing up, you might win some swag. On the topic of swag, everyone that won on the Christmas giveaway, she's been four hats, some pre-emergent soil test kit, and the grand prize, which was the carbon kit, 10,000 square foot carbon kit, so the big mamma jamma. All of that should have been shipped. You guys should have, if you've not received it yet, you should be getting them soon. So if not, let me know, but you should be getting all your goodies soon. Thank you guys so much for participating in that. Again, hopefully everyone is doing well. It's been a rough past 6 weeks. You know, everyone had all the plans for over the holidays, Thanksgiving, Christmas, and then this new variant came out and, you know, made a mess of things. So so hopefully you guys are all doing well out there. Let's see what else we got in the live stream tonight. We got VMH in the house. He's saying, happy Friday. What's going on? Hopefully you're doing well, sir. VMH, happy new year. Glad to see you're here. And then Jeremy is proposing a very, an excellent, excellent question. He's saying, so what is everybody drinking on tonight? You guys know me. It's tonight. I've got my lemonade. Tonight, going premium, man. I'm going with Milo's. You guys, obviously, you can't see that it's Milo's, but it's Milo's. It's like half water, half Milo's mix. My normal vintage. So yeah, that's what I'm gonna be drinking on tonight. And I got a bowl of fruit here, but I thought, you know what? It's just me. So me snacking while I'm trying to answer questions. Probably not gonna be the best thing. So I'm just gonna sit there and just use that as motivation to get through the live stream, so I can have my strawberries and blackberries and grapes and. Look at that. You guys can check that out. That's my plan for after the show. My little snack for after the show. So yeah, for me, it is lemonade, Jeremy. Hopefully you're doing well, sir. Let's see who else we have in the show tonight. Okay, it didn't take... How long are we in? We're 2 minutes in. It didn't take very long. It didn't take very long at all. Actually, before we get to Cedric's comment, I got a super chat down here from Lois. Let me go and take care of that. Thank you so much, Lois. I really do appreciate it. Happy New Year's. Just happy New Year, everybody. Hey, Ron, you earned 5 stars for customer service. Thank you for sharing your knowledge so freely with us as lawn enthusiasts. You're very, very welcome, Lois. Again, I apologize for the delay on getting that stuff to you. You know, it should be to you Monday. Again, my apologies. And, you know, all we can do is do our best to try and make it right when those things happen. Fortunately, it's not a common thing, but I'm glad that we got you taken care of. And you know what? For you having the first super chat tonight, and also looks like so far the largest super chat, I'm going to start something new here. I think you are going to be our show sponsor tonight. So let me do some quick typing here. Lois H. So there you go. Until you're dethroned, unless someone does a super chat more than $49.95, you are the sponsor of the show for tonight. So I appreciate the generosity. Thank you so much. I really do appreciate it. Next up, we have a super chat here from Mr. Papa Mose Lowe in the house. What's going on, sir, from Mr. Al from Alabama?
Super chat received.
Says, thanks for all your advice this past year. No problem at all, Papa Mose Lowe. I'm sure that, you know, I'm glad that it was helpful. I know that we get, you know, this season is starting out pretty wild as far as the winter temperatures. And let's just hope that we get an early spring, early green up, and get the lawn looking its best sooner than later. It's been really crazy. I got some pictures and videos to show you guys of the lawn here in a second. Once I cut over to that, I took some video today from like mowing it and everything else I've been just doing with the lawn, just getting it cleaned up, so you guys can see the current state of the madness. All right, so back to Cedric's comment. He says, "Big Ron, don't give up on the Bulldogs. It will happen this time." All right, if you say so. It says, I saw your stripe action today looking like a winner. A large portion of my lawn doesn't want to go to sleep. She refuses to go to bed. Yeah, man. So it's been, calling this winter has been a bit of a misnomer, because it's not, it's up until this week, it's actually been fairly warm here in Georgia. The lawn, you know, as you guys have seen, if you follow my YouTube stories, a more than ever has happened in the past of my back lawn has not gone to sleep, has not gone dormant. And then the front lawn is looking really, really green, or much greener than it should for this time of year. So if you guys want to see pictures of that, I can show you guys now. Why not? Tedric is saying too much carbon in her system. So I took a shot a video of it after taking care of the lawn today. I'll show you the video here now. So this is the back lawn. So what I did is I first got the true cut out and mowed the lawn lengthwise. And you know me, right? I couldn't leave well enough alone. You know, the true cut did a decent job cleaning things up a little bit, but I said, you know what? It looks good, but it would look even better if I put the Greens Master on it. So I went out there and I did a cleanup patch with the Greens Master. So it got double cut today. The entire lawn got double cut. And the stripe action you guys saw there is from the results of that. So we got cut with the true cut first and then the Greens Master. And before any of you guys ask, the height of cut is 3/4 of an inch. I'm thinking that's what I'm going to be doing this year, guys. The lawn, I think, looks its best between 1/2 inch and 3/4 of an inch and really closer to that 3/4 of an inch number. So that's what I'm going to stick with this year. We'll see how that works, but that is that's the plan. As far as the front lawn, so I was telling you guys how green the lawn is. That's what the front lawn looks like as of this morning. So it is January 7th, and you can see that's still a lot of green for, you know, the beginning of winter, well into winter. So pretty crazy. So we'll see how well it holds out. Temps are starting to fall now, so might not. I might be, I might have to look at these pictures or these images as a distant memory. But as of right now, the lawn is looking much greener than it ever has this time of year, largely due to temperatures, low height of cut, plenty of carbon, like all the good stuff I've been doing to it this year. So, all right, very good stuff. All right, next up, we got Clayton in the house. He says, hey, happy Friday, Ron. Did your lawn green up that much? I got some green, but wow. Yeah, man, that's exactly what you, like the images you just saw. The back lawn, again, not as much as the front. You can see over here towards the far end, you can see the back lawn has some green, but it's largely dormant. But the front lawn greened up really, it's just never gone dormant. You know, for a while there in December, late December, we had a stretch there where we had temps in the 60s and a couple days, even in the 70s for a 2-week period thereabouts. And the lawn just loved it. It just woke up and got nice and green. Now, granted, I can show you, like going forward, looks like we are in for much cooler weather. So tomorrow, 47, Sunday, 50, 52, 46. So temps are getting a little bit cooler, but still relatively warm for winter months. So I don't expect the lawn to go fully dormant. Might be putting up pre-emergent a little bit earlier this year than last year. So we'll see. But yeah, lawn is definitely much greener than usual. And it's not just me. I think Daryl, some others have commented, sent me images saying the same thing, that their lawns are also greener than usual this time of year as well too. So great stuff. All right, we got Robert Rainey in the house saying, good evening, everyone. What's going on, Robert? Hopefully you are doing well. Hopefully you're doing well, sir. And let's see what else we got. We already got took care of Lois's super chat. We got Papa Mo's Low in the house. The Alabama contingent is in the house. You know, we'll see, guys. I'm not going to talk smack. I mean, here's the thing. The Dogs lost the first time around when it didn't. I mean, it counted, but it didn't really count. Now, Monday, we're going to find out if they learned from it, if they can, you know, rise to the occasion and finally get a national championship. Every time you hear the Bulldogs being mentioned, it's always like, oh, yeah, the last time they won was like 1980. So we'll see. We'll see if they get it done. My confidence is not high. If they win, great. If they don't, just Georgia being Georgia. So. And if there's any Bulldog fans, I apologize, but it's hard to keep the faith with the way things have been going. But we'll see. I'm holding out hope that Monday will go our way. We'll see. All right, next up we got Daryl Tunstall in the house. He says, what's up, Ron? Putting down carbon this morning. Daryl, I like the avatar, man. That's clean. Greens Master's looking hot in that avatar. Looking nice. I like it. Nice change, sir. You said you put down some carbon. It's good. Always good. I did the same thing. So after, what you guys are looking at here in this video is after it being mowed, I put down a total of four bags of Essential G over the entire lawn. I did three bags in the back lawn, back in swale area, and then one over the entire front lawn. And that's what you guys are looking at as far as that. So today the lawn got double cut, true cut first, Greens Master second, and then four bags of Essential G to help feed that soil, get it ready, have it in its best shape for the spring whenever it gets here. It's trying to get here a little early, but yeah. So yeah, looking forward to it. All right, next up we got Papa Mo's Lil with a question. He says, Ron, neighbor's weeds creeping into my lawn. Is it too cold to spray Celsius Certainty Combo now or better to wait till spring? Really better to wait till the spring. There's not really a ton of guidance around as far as like temperature restrictions. I will tell you for Celsius, like the label does specify that any time with soil temps are lower than 65 degrees, which they more than likely are where you are right now. I think you're in Alabama, Birmingham or something like that. So if the soil temps are below 65 degrees, it's going to be a lot slower acting. So it's going to take a lot longer to kill the weeds, a lot longer to work. That's most of the guidance that I've seen. Now, it hasn't said anything that it's not going to work. It's just that it's going to be a lot slower. If you want to give it a shot, it's not going to hurt anything. It's not going to hurt anything to give to try it out if you'd like. It's just that combination is relatively expensive. So, you know, just depends on how much you feel like risking getting a good result or not. I'll tell you this way, like compared to Spectracide, if I had a choice between doing Spectracide this time of year or doing Certainty Celsius, I would opt for Certainty Celsius this time of year more so than Spectracide. So, but yeah, I mean, it is on the cooler side of temperatures. I would like December would have been like late last month would have been a perfect time to do it because temps were in the 60s and some days even the 70s. Now though, with things cooling off, you can give it a shot, but it's going to be slower. Don't be surprised if you do your application and a week, 2 weeks goes by and you're not really seeing a lot of response in the weeds from it. So just something to keep in mind, give it a shot, report back. I've never sprayed it this time of year to know, but yeah, give it a shot and see. Can't hurt anything. All it is some herbicide, right? All right, next up we have a new member. Thank you so much, Nestor. Nestor Reyes just became a member of the channel. So for those of you guys that don't know, something I did over the Christmas break is to turn on channel memberships for the YouTube channel. So the way that works is like, I think, five levels of channel membership. So if you're interested in that, you can join. Obviously, you have to be signed in, which I'm not on this here. And because I'm the channel owner, I'm not sure if it would even work. But yeah, we now have channel memberships right now. It's limited to avatars. We've got some community posts that are only for channel members. So there's the ones that I always do that you guys see, but then also I'm going to be doing some ones regularly for just people that are channel members to see some behind the scenes. Like if you actually want to see what the actual studio looks like, there's an actual picture of it taken from like this angle here shooting in, so you can see how everything, like the depth of everything and everything I've got in here. You can get a recent shot of the, you guys, I'm sitting here pointing it like you guys can see it, of the new piece of artwork that I had added, which is kind of cool. A good buddy of mine who's a really good artist did his take on Napoleon crossing the Alps. So it's like a play on that. So added some artwork to the studio. So yeah, if you're interested in that kind of stuff, feel free to check it out, and there you go. And while we're in here, guys, you know, we've got 62 people in the live stream, but only 29 likes. Guys, it's time. You know, I hate that I have to do this all the time and beg and plead for the likes, but let's just have like a small moment together here and realize that it's a free way for you guys to support the channel. It's even cheaper than joining the channel as far as like channel memberships. So if you guys wouldn't mind touching that like button ever so gently, even the haters, if you're out there, I know you guys are out there. If you guys can't even resist, if you got to put a dislike, because I know how the haters have to do, right? That's fine too. Just let me feel some love from you guys, knowing that you guys are appreciating, you know, first part of January, getting together, getting the live stream out and answering your lawn care questions. Free to do. Great way for me to now take a sip of my lemonade while I wait for you guys to do that. Very much appreciated. Uh-huh. Tasty. Milo's is good lemonade. I got to hand it, Oklahoma, they make good lemonade. I got to hand it to them. This is like if Chick-fil-A sold this, we would not be too far behind. This is actually an excellent lemonade. So you come like in a glass bottle. It's really that good. But thanks so much, Nestor. I really do appreciate the love and support. All right. Next up, we got Mr. Windchariot in the house, sitting down with a bowl of chili in hand, ready to sit back and enjoy the show. Thanks so much for that, Windchariot. Appreciate you coming to hang out. And then next up, we have Alex B in the house. Says, Happy New Year, Ron. Definitely not your scene up by me in New Jersey at the moment. Just cleared about 6 inches of snow. That sounds horrible. And dealing with a big temp drop. At least I got just to try out my spare snowblower. That's the thing, you know, that's the one thing that's interesting about you guys that are up north, Alex. I imagine you guys have got to have bigger garages or sheds to keep all your stuff, because there's an entire set of equipment that you guys need that we down here in the South never need. Like, if you could buy a snowblower in Georgia, but you'd use it maybe 2 days out of the year if we get snow. This year's not looking like we're going to get any. So it's interesting that you guys have, you know, you have all your regular lawn care equipment and then all of your, you know, your winter cleanup equipment. But yeah, man. Yeah. It's definitely a lot nicer weather here than that. We are not dealing with 6 inches of snow. I could not imagine what would happen to Georgia if we got 6 inches of snow. Everything would shut down. Shut down worse than usual. All right. Next up, we got Joseph Roberts in the house. He says, hey, hello, everyone. Happy New Year. Happy Friday. What's going on, Joseph? Thanks for coming to hang out, sir. Appreciate you. And then Robert says he's glad to announce that the burr weed is no longer a problem. Thanks, everyone. So what do we end up doing, Robert? I know we tried a couple of things. I think it was suggested Spectracide, and then we also suggested Celsius as well. So what was the actual, what actually did the trick? What actually took care of the burr weed? Let us know down in the comment what ended up being the fix for the problem. You know, on the topic of weeds, guys, I've been getting some emails from you guys, some about pre-emergent, when is the time to do pre-emergent, as far, and also as around like winter weeds, treating winter weeds. Here's the thing, as far as pre-emergent, it really, traditional guidance is going to say like late February, early March, but the best answer, the most accurate answer is it depends. It really depends. If we get like another warm snap like we've been having for the most part, right, where temps are relatively mild, especially if you're in Georgia and Florida, you know, I mean, if you want to get your pre-emergent down earlier in the, like late winter, early spring, there's nothing wrong with that. Like we did Alex's lawn last year in the last week of January as an experiment just to see, and it worked out great. He had no issues with weeds in his lawn all throughout the summer, throughout the growing months. And given how we have, it never gets really, really super cold here to where even the weeds kind of shut down and go away. You know, it's almost one of those things where keeping pre-emergent down is not necessarily not a bad idea, you know, especially if you are in the warmer climates, and especially when you have warmer temps, a warmer winter, a milder winter like what we've been experiencing here in the Southeast United States. So just something to keep in mind. I'm glad to hear that you got the burr weed under control, Robert. And yeah, man, good thing that you made progress with that. All right, next up we have someone new. I've not seen this one before. Kilting in the lawn. You know, I gotta hand it to you. You know, I can't see the avatar that well. It looks like you're pulling off wearing a kilt fairly well, sir. Not everyone can do that. I don't know. I don't know that I could pull off a kilt. We're never gonna find out if I could pull off a kilt. I'll say that. Fairly confident. Like I'll wear like a roll tie jersey before I wear a kilt. But yeah, interesting, man. It's cool. Kilting the lawn. Is it a YouTube channel associated with it? If so, I'll have to go check it out after the show's over. That's definitely a name for a channel that no one will forget. So very, very, very cool. Hopefully you're doing well, and thanks for coming to hang out in the live stream. All right, we got Connor Souls in the house saying, Happy Ron, hopefully you're doing well. Thanks so much, Connor. I appreciate you as well. Looks like we got another super chat down here. Let me run down here and grab that. Okay, wow. So Merrill, so you're gonna dethrone Lowe's by 4 cents. Super chat received. So a super chat from Merrill Williams says, from Happy Friday, Ron, and everyone. Ron, is it safe to scalp new zoysia that is not a year old yet? Thanks and go dogs. So I think you are now the channel's sponsor, Merrill, because you did like 4 cents more than Lois. So you are the channel sponsor as of right now at $49.99. So congratulations. To answer your question, I would not be in a rush to scalp the lawn. I wouldn't do it now. Actually, I need to move this because actually I'm talking into your face. Let's try that. That looks better. All right. So you said it's not a year old as yet. You know, I'd say right now, no, I would not scalp the lawn now. If when later on in the spring rolls around, like late March, early April, if you wanted to scalp then, you could consider it. But I mean, it also depends on what you're trying to accomplish, right? Like scalping is really something you're doing just to get rid of some of the dead clippings and to kind of do like a high to cut reset. So it depends on what kind of height you're planning to maintain the zoysia at. So let's say, for example, as a thought experiment, let's say right now your zoysia is at 1.25 inches, right? So 1.25 inches. And you decide you're going to real mow this year and you want to take it down to an inch. Then yeah, when springtime rolls around, if you wanted to bring the height of cut down to just under half an inch, you know, we'll say 7/8, you know, 3/4 of an inch, 7/8, something like that, like a mild scalp, then that makes sense. What I would not do is if you're trying to maintain the line at an inch, don't cut it down to like half an inch or below half an inch. Like there's no reason to subject it to that much stress and abuse, especially when there's no plans for you to maintain it at a height of cut anywhere near that. So really, you want to scalp the lawn or just bring it down just under the height of cut that you plan to maintain the lawn as. That's what I would recommend, especially with it being newer turf, zoysia being a slower growing grass. There's no reason to add unnecessary injury to it just for the sake of doing it. You know, and again, here's the thing: you don't really even have to scalp your lawn. Like scalping is one of those things that yes, it does promote green up a bit faster. It's a week or two in some cases, sometimes even more. But it's not strictly necessary. And I am a fan of taking off just enough. You know, you don't need to get there and take the lawn down to dirt unless you're trying to really maintain the lawn super short like last year. Last year, I got kind of crazy and decided I was going to try out half an inch like a crazy person. And I don't think I'm going to be doing that again this year. Granted, you guys know me. I always say I'm never doing that again. And the next thing you know, I'm out doing it. But I would say there's no problem with scalping zoysia that's not a year old. I would just make it very mild. So whatever height of cut you're trying to maintain the lawn at, take it just below that. No super crazy heavy scalps is what I would. I definitely wouldn't do that this time of year, or even in the springtime. There's no reason to do it, especially as slow as zoysia grows. All right, great question. You said thanks and go dogs, man. Hopefully they can pull it off. Hopefully the red and black can do it. Hopefully them dogs can get this time done this time around. All right, next up we have another super chat, and then I got to roll back up here and see everyone else that's in the house from Mark F. Thank you so much, Mark. Super chat received. Mark's like, I'm going to raise him by one penny. and you did, sir. So new channel sponsor, new stream sponsor or show sponsor for tonight. So we'll say Mark F. Thanks for the advice earlier. Yeah, no problem at all, Mark. So you guys could know, Mark's question, he's in Arizona, I believe, and he was the one that did the rye grass. He had like a lot of weeds that he was dealing with. He first did rye, and then his questions were around, hey, you know, when springtime rolls around, if I'm going to try and seed Bermuda, what options do I have around herbicide? And I just went back and forth with him and said, hey, like, you know, if you're going to seed it, then absolutely you can't do pre-emergent. Just don't do that. You're just going to be working against yourself. Not a great plan to do that. What I'd almost recommend, Mark, and I've already put this in email, but I'll answer it again here anyway, just for everyone else's benefit, is that if you can do sod, like if we find out, right, that now that you have all the seed, all the spurge gone, and that when warm temps are regularly here and the Bermuda's not growing through, like it's really thin and patchy and you just don't want to wait for it to grow in, I would much rather recommend that you do sod than seed, because it's going to be, here's the thing, you're in Arizona, so the watering requirements for seed are going to be crazy expensive. Like your watering bill is going to cost, you know, several orders of magnitude more than the seed's going to cost you. It's going to take longer to establish. And, you know, as far as your ability to do any kind of pre-emergent, you're really going to want to stay away from that if you do seed. You do sod, right? Here's what we could do. If you decided you were going to do sod, say, in the late spring, early summer, you could do pre-emergent next month, you know, get the weeds under control, prevent a big problem with a lot of summer weeds. And then if you want to install sod, you know, May, June, that's going to work out just fine. Especially with you doing Bermuda, it's going to be fine. If you're doing seed, I mean, really, you're just going to want to stay away from any kind of pre-emergent. It's just, especially being where you are and the amount of water you're going to put down, you just don't want to take the chance of spending all that money and not getting the results. So hopefully that helps. I know I answered an email, but hey, you gave me a super chat and I felt compelled that everyone else would have to know the backstory as well too. So now they do. And we'll see. You still got plenty of time to figure it out and decide on it. So we will, hopefully that helps you out as far as answers. And right now, the hardest part of anytime I scroll down to get super chats is finding where I left off. All right, I think it's so we already talked to Connor Souls. Happy Friday, Ron. Happy Friday, Connor. I am doing well. Thanks so much. Trying to stay healthy. You know, it's this new variant going around has been nasty, man. Like everyone, I shouldn't say nasty. It doesn't seem like it's quite as lethal. But as far as like everybody and their grandmother catching it is has been a thing. So, you know, just wash your hands. Don't kiss strange people. And drink lots of fluids, take care of yourself. But yeah, I'm doing well. Thanks for asking. I do appreciate it. All right, next up, Troy Willard Ridley's in the house. Says, hello, Ron and all. Thanks, Troy, for coming to hang out in the live stream tonight. Our next question is from Mr. Rob Schott. Rob Schott says, happy new year, Ron. Happy new year, Rob. Hopefully you're doing well. He says, my Empire Zoysia is all over the place here in Panama City. Some green, some brown, some red tips. I put down Dithiope here a little late. Should I be looking at fungicides? So you said you're seeing some red. That could be from all, or you said Panama City. So here's the thing. In the last, I'm not sure if all the rain that we were getting in Georgia in the last couple of weeks also got down to Panama City. If you want to do fungicide, I mean, if it's like red thread, I mean, I personally wouldn't this time of year. I would wait till a little bit later in the season, you know, late February, early March, before doing fungicides. I mean, it's your call. You didn't send me pictures of the lawns. So I don't know how bad it is. If it's just a few areas here, small areas here and there, especially if you've had a lot of rain to where that's what's causing the problem, then I would delay that. I'd hold off on it. But if you send me pictures and you got like, you know, it's a big problem all over the place, you got fungus problems all over, then you could consider doing a fungicide, especially with you being in Panama City. Like it doesn't get terribly cold there. So answers, it depends, sir. As far as some of your lawn being green, some of it being brown, welcome to winter life. That sounds a lot like my lawn. Other than the front lawn, which is, the front lawn's probably 50-50. It's probably about half green, half brown. But the back lawn, if you saw from earlier, the video from earlier, actually, I'll just have that one while I tell you about it. The back lawn, as you can tell, there in the back right now on the left, you see there's plenty of green there. The rest of it is mostly brown. There's some green sprinkled throughout. That is par for the course for this time of year. That's completely normal. So I honestly wouldn't sweat it too much. You said you put down Dithiope here a little late. I mean, I'm not sure how late is a little bit late. You know, if you did an application in the last 2 months, I would let that ride for a little bit longer, because really with you being in Panama City, late February, early March, which is only, you know, 60 days from now, you're going to be able to get down your pre-emergent then. You know, if you want to do coastal, you could do that. If you wanted to do prodiamine, you could do that. You could tons of options. So I wouldn't be in a rush to do pre-emergent again as yet. I would not be in a rush to do fungicide, depending on the extent of the issue you're dealing with. I would just let it ride, man. Just relax, enjoy the somewhat cool, warm weather that we're having, and see how things go. If you want, so if I'm getting this wrong, because the problem is worse than I think it is, feel free to send me an email. There's my email address, ron@golfcourselawn. I'm gonna do this. It's hard to do on this camera angle. Can't do it. There we go. ron@golfcourselawn.com, right there, with pictures, and I'll take a look, and then we can revisit it if you want. But just from based on what you're telling me, I think you should just let it ride. That is my thought. Those are my thoughts on the matter, sir. Thanks for the question. All right, next up we have Michael Anger. He says, I'm in North Georgia. What part of Georgia are you in? I am also in North Georgia. I'm in Northeast Georgia, so near Gainesville area. That's a part of the great state of Georgia that I am in. What part of Georgia are you in? Where in North Georgia are you, Michael? All right, next up we got Adrian E. saying Happy New Year's. Love you, bro. I appreciate it. Love you too. Thanks so much for coming to hang out in the live stream. I appreciate all the love and support. And then we have Left Tool in the house. He says, he's not talking to me. I thought he was saying like, hey, Ron. He's like, hey, Papa. Happy New Year's, Ron and all. What's going on? Happy New Year's, Left Tool. Hope you're doing well. Hopefully. You know, here's the thing. I keep confusing you and your, I don't confuse you and your brother, but one of you guys had, well, you didn't actually have the baby. One of you guys had a baby late last year. I think it was you. I think it was you. But anyway, hopefully the little one's doing well and everything's doing well. Everyone's staying healthy. And that Tahoma, I haven't seen any videos from you guys lately. You got to let us know, man, how the Tahoma's doing, how the Tahoma 31 is holding up as far as, I imagine it's probably more dormant than than what we have here in Georgia. But, you know, with you guys being in Arkansas, it'd be interesting to find out how the Tahoma is doing. If you can, man, drop a chat down, drop us a message down below. Let us know how it's doing. Inquiring minds want to know. Inquiring minds want to know. All right, next up we got Connor Soul says, wow, 47 degrees and a green front lawn. I wish. Snowed 7 inches in New Jersey today. Yeah, that sounds horrible, man. Snow is one of those things where it's a cool novelty. Granted, here's the thing, I'm a bit biased, because being from the Caribbean, anything below 65 degrees is officially cold. But snow is one of those things that when it falls and you see everything and it looks really pretty and you're inside your house with a nice cup of like hot chocolate or eggnog or whatever you happen to drink whenever it's snowing outside, you know, that's when it's nice. But then as soon as you have to go into the outside and have to live in said snow, not fun, not a fan at all. Actually, fun fact, Connor, the first time I ever saw snow was in New Jersey. Like the first time in my entire life, it was probably 16, 17 years ago. At this point, it was in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. That was the first time that I ever saw snow, touch snow with my, for the real time in my life. And it was horrible. That was not a good introduction to snow. Cherry Hill in the middle of winter. It's when I was traveling a lot. But yeah, man, glad you're doing well. Sorry you had to deal with 7 inches of snow, but I appreciate you coming to hang out in the live stream anyway. Appreciate all the love and support. Papa Mo's low. Here we go. He says, I'm in Bama, but I yell go dogs. My neighbors love me. We'll see, man. It'd be nice to win. Here's the thing. I think Georgia fans would say, even if we got a win this year and we didn't get another one for like another 10 years, I think we would take that. I think we take it. I think Georgia has, you know, we're at the point where we've got a great team. It would be nice just to win. It'd be nice to be the bride instead of the bridesmaid all the time. It'd be nice. On the topic of that, I'm not sure if he's in the live stream tonight. He's not. I don't think he is. He's probably still living his best life down in Mexico. But congratulations to Devin, and I think his fiance, because I think she said yes, is either Rachel or Raquel. I think he got engaged here in the last week or so. So if you guys are watching, congratulations. If you're not watching, congratulations. And if you watch later, congratulations. Congrats on getting engaged. So very, very cool stuff, sir. Once you get back here stateside, we got a schedule getting you on the show so you can tell us all about the story. The weather and the pictures looked awesome. But I definitely wanted to make sure I mentioned that and tell you guys congrats. So very, very cool stuff. Okay, Alex B saying, wow, Ron, that front yard is looking super green for this time of year for your area and grass type. Yeah, dude, because it's crazy, right? Because it's been unseasonably warm. It's been crazy warm this year compared to years past. This is going to be, I think, year 6 or 7 since being here. And the front lawn has never been that green this time of year. There's also another lawn in the neighborhood, another guy in the neighborhood that has, he also maintains his lawn very short, even over the winter months too. And his lawn looks a lot like my front lawn as well. It's also like that, that salt and pepper green brown thing going on. And Alex's lawn looks somewhat like that as well too. Not quite as green, but it's similar. And what I attribute that to is one, super, super healthy soil, right? So like the carbon program where the lawn is getting Essential G as well as, well, not the carbon kit now, but the Essential G every month now coming up, we're coming up on almost 2 years now, every single month has definitely helped improve the quality of the soil. And then you combine that with warmer temperatures and a lower height of cut. So where the lawn is maintained shorter and it's easier for it to turn green. As soon as we get any kind of warm temps, the grass just wants to grow. Which is really cool. Definitely really speaks a lot for adding a granular carbon program to what you're doing in your lawn care. So, I mean, the proof's in the pudding, man. You look at my lawn and Alex's lawn and then the other lawns around here, the differences in color is that. That's what we're doing, right? It's mainly the height of cut and also like just how well we take care of the soil. So great, great stuff. All right, next up, we got Gary H. saying, thanks for representing the dogs. Yeah, man, I've got my love is Georgia. I got a lot of friends that are Georgia. Here's the thing. If they were to lose, you know, I already been threatening some of my friends that I'm going to go out and I'm going to get like an Alabama jersey. There's some guy on the Alabama, on the Crimson Tide, whose name is Kool-Aid, or I think he goes by Kool-Aid. And that's kind of a cool jersey. So if Alabama wins, and if I do get like a jersey, like the Kool-Aid is a pretty cool name to have on the back of your uh, back your jersey. I guess you guys probably know any, you know, Crimson Tide fans probably know who I'm talking about. But yeah, something like that. But yeah, hopefully they can pull it off, man. Hopefully they can pull it off. You know, confidence is not high, but we shall see. We shall see. Mike Rob 1404 says they made Bama an underdog. Feed the monster. Yeah, they need to not do that. See, you notice, you know what Kirby says. Even even Herschel was smart about it. Like whenever they ask Herschel, saying, "Hey, you know what's going to happen with Alabama and Georgia?" He says, "Hey, you know Alabama's a great team. They're a really strong team. They play really good football, and it's going to be really hard for Georgia." They're not giving them any kind of fuel. And then you know all the other commentators are trying to give Alabama a reason to beat us. And who knows? They probably will, but it'd be nice if Georgia won. All right, next up we got Kodiak Wild in the house saying, He says, "Don't kill a strip of the neighbor's lawn spraying for weeds." Okay. Are you saying that you are, I mean, I'm not trying to accuse you or anything, but are you suggesting that someone, not you, was trying to spray for weeds near their neighbor's lawn and they happened to, you know, spray or touch the neighbor's lawn and kill off part of the neighbor's lawn? It can happen. It can happen. But yeah, I mean, you know, on the topic of weeds, you know, what's funny, I talk about people about me in a kilt and oh, man, this is not funny. It was, someone sent me, have you guys seen the Samuel L. Jackson, you know, when he was, I forget what movie it was, but it was him in a kilt. This is what I would look like in a kilt. Let me see if I can pull it up here. It's not like, I mean, I don't know. I think it's the confidence that you have to wear it with. So that would be me in a kilt. You got Samuel L. With his clubs. And I think if you got the confidence to pull it off, I think it could be all right. But I just don't know that I could do it, guys. I don't know that I could pull that off. I just don't think so. But yeah, anyway, I brought it up, and of course, someone's got to harass me. Some of my my viewers that have my number that were texting me, they were saying, "Hey man, look, you killed, awesome." So, anyway, but yeah, it happens. Just be careful. You know, be careful when you're spraying near your neighbor's lawn. And on the topic of that, again, hopefully this year is a prime example. And I've said it in some of the live in the YouTube stories as well that I've been doing when I've gone out there shooting images of the lawn. A perfect example of this is why spraying glyphosate, even when the lawn is air quotes dormant, is a terrible idea. Like that, if I were to go out and I'd spray for weeds on my lawn, granted there's no weeds there now, but if I were gonna do that, like that would be a perfect example where a lawn like that, I would absolutely destroy it. Like next year, I would wake up, or next spring, I'd wake up and I'd have all kinds of dead patches in my lawn. So, don't spray non-selective herbicides in your lawn this time of year. Don't do it, regardless of anyone tells you. Don't do it. All right. So next up, I think there's another super chat down here. I gotta go get. Let me roll down here and see what we got. We got one from Daryl Tunstall. Thank you so much, Daryl. Appreciate you.
Super chat received.
Thanks for the love and support, Daryl. I do appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks much, sir. And I'm looking forward to hearing you do that thing we were talking about. We've been emailing back and forth. You need to go in and get started. You gotta let me know. Once you do, let me get it started and let me know, and I will let people know, man. So yeah. Thanks for the super chat. I do appreciate it. Okay, next up, Juan Hernandez says, "Hey man, 1 month until pre-emergent." Yeah, pretty much. I mean, Juan Henriquez, depending on where you are, if you're around here and the temps are like how they're looking now, to where, you know, we start getting another warm snap, you know, February, you could be doing pre-emergent easily. You easily could be doing that. It just depends on, you know, what the temperatures do, and that's going to be the main driving factor for that, right? So. But yeah, not too far away from that at all. All right, next comment we have is around the height of cut, but the height of cut we're going to be maintaining is from 1320 straight liner. Someone that spent some time with the drag strip, obviously, down to 1320, says, "I let my Bermuda get too tall. Will it hurt if I start taking down a little during the winter to get a start on a jump on next season? I plan to try to maintain 1.25 inch." You said next year, but do you mean this year? Okay, great question. So the answer is no. It's not going to hurt anything. I actually did that last season. Worked out great. Alex did that. Worked out really, really well. I don't know where you are, 1320. The only thing I'd say, right, is let's say you are in Arkansas or somewhere, you know, further north where you might get, you know, a bunch of snow on the ground and the, you know, where there's a chance of potential damage to the lawn from excessively cold temps. That's where, you know, maybe leaving it a little bit taller is not necessarily going to hurt anything. But if you're in Georgia, you know, yeah, absolutely. You can begin working the height of cut down. You didn't tell us what your current height of cut is, like where you are. But let's say if you want to maintain at 1 1/4 inch, and right now you're at say 2 inches, right? Let's say you have a 2 inch lawn right now. What you could do is you could go from like say 2 inches down to 1.5 inches, just take like 1/2 inch off. And then whenever March rolls around, March, you know, April timeframe, whenever you decide you're going to do your scalp, then you could do the rest of it. And it saves you a lot of headache because if you have, again, if you go back to that example of say your lawn is 2 inches and you're trying to take off 3/4 of an inch of grass, it doesn't sound like a lot, but that's a lot of grass, man. That's a lot of material to remove. And, you know, to save you, you know, hours and hours of just emptying bags, you know, while you're trying to do this, I'm definitely a fan of doing scalping in phases. There's nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that at all. So yeah, take off a little bit. And then, you know, if you want to, a month from now, 2 months from now, you want to take off a little bit more, then you can do that as well too. So it's just, you can do it either anywhere you want, but it is going to be less work and you are going to get a better result by doing it in phases versus trying to lop it all off at one time. You know, you'll be hating life a lot less if you do it in steps. I want to say BYD this year started his scalp already. I want to say that BYD already did. I did it last year, and I believe that BYD started his scalp, and he is in Georgia, I think Stockbridge or something like that. He started his already as well. So yeah, absolutely no problem. Just do it in phases. Take your time, and you're gonna save yourself a lot of headache by doing that. Great question. All right, next up, we have a comment from Mr. Matthew Parks saying, Milo's lemonade and sweet tea are the goat. Now, I've never had the sweet tea. Lemonade's good. Lemonade is really good. I'm not, you know, here's the thing, and I know this is sacrilegious. I'm probably going to get a lot of hate for this, but I'm not a huge sweet tea person. I'm just not. I mean, I'll have like an Arnold, is it an Arnold Palmer? Where they do the, it's like half lemonade, half iced tea. Like I've done those are okay, but like straight sweet tea, I've not taken on that much here, you know, as yet. So yeah, but I'm sure it's good. If the lemonade's any reflection, I'm sure the sweet tea is really good as well, Matthew. So thanks for giving the feedback. You said I keep Milo's in my fridge. Yeah, man, it's definitely become definitely in the fridge. I tend to have the Publix lemonade in the fridge and the Milo's mainly because my Publix is closer. There's only a couple of places around here, like Kroger, I think, carries Milo's, and there's not one that's super nearby, so I got to go drive a little bit to go get it. So there's typically Publix always in there, and then the Milo's, like the good stuff, I break out for like the live stream. If I want to feel a little fancy when I'm having my lemonade, then I'll get the Milo's out. But yeah, I agree with you. It's excellent, excellent stuff. All right, next up, we get cars and motorcycles and exotics. Says, Ron, I sent my lawn sample and it recommended the 1608 Lebanon on turf. When do I put that out in Northwest Florida? Whenever the lawn starts actively growing. So I wouldn't do it now. You said Northwest Florida, so panhandle-ish, I guess. We'll say Tallahassee. Okay, so we'll say Northwest-ish Florida on the panhandle somewhere. March timeframe. I am not going to start fertilizing the lawn until March. Even my lawn, it's just, there's just, until the grass, till the turf is actively growing, there's just not a lot of reason to do it. So if you're trying to apply it when you can get the best bang for your buck and the grass is really actively growing to take advantage of it, March timeframe is going to be when you're going to want to do that. So go ahead and stock up now. The price on Humic Max is still really, really good. Go ahead and take advantage of that. But really, I would hold off until March before you apply it. Whenever the grass is actively growing, that's the correct answer. So if we get like crazy temps and it turns in like 75 degrees from here on out and the grass starts growing like crazy in February, then do it in February. But if history is any marker for what to expect, March is going to be a better choice as far as when to put down your fertilizer to get the lawn going for this year. So hopefully that helps. Great question. And good job on getting a soil test done. It's pretty awesome. Very, very cool. We got a super chat. Let me go and take care of that from Straight Liner. Thank you so much, Straight Liner. Appreciate you so much.
Super chat received.
I appreciate it. And then, oh, we got another one here from Mr. Josh Habib, taking over the top spot as a show sponsor. Mr. Josh Habib. Josh, how you doing, man? Hopefully you're doing well, sir. Thanks for coming to hang out.
Super chat.
This is Happy New Year, Doctor. Looking forward to the new season. Hope you're doing well. I am doing well. Trying to survive, you know, all this craziness circling in the air, you know, Rona and whatnot doing its thing. But yeah, I'm hanging in there. Hanging in there. I got went out and double cut the lawn today. Thank you so much for the super chat. Super, super generous. And you are now taking over the top spot as the show sponsor. So Josh Habib, let me put you in there. Thanks for that. And Josh, again, thank you so much, man, for all of the support over this past season. You know, I thanked you numerous times, but really, you know, a lot of the really cool hats and stuff, like a good example, like this hat right here. This is one of my favorites, the clean hats like this. These are all from Josh, man. You know, he sends me stuff to give away on the live stream and also some stuff for me just to wear during making the videos. And I really, really appreciate all the love and support. So thank you so much for that. A lot of the cool stickers you guys get, like Josh is the guy that designed a lot of that stuff. So I appreciate all your love and support over last year and into this year. And hopefully you and the fam and everyone else are doing well. Hopefully you're doing well, man. Stay healthy out there. You know, don't do anything I would do. And, you know, send me some pictures of the lawn, man. I'd like to see how the lawn is doing. I know you're a little bit further north than I am, but it'd be interesting to know what the lawn is looking like this time of year. Appreciate the support, sir. All right, next up, Robert Rainey says, we use the Ron Henry combo. Okay, cool. So you use the Celsius Certainty combo. Nice. Yeah, that's a great, great combination. The only negative I can really say about Celsius Certainty is a bit expensive. You know, Celsius is $110 thereabouts for a bottle of it. And then Certainty, that's off my head. I think it's close to that again. It's like you're showing about $200 all in between both of them. But then you've got like a really baller combination for taking care of weeds in warm season turfs, which is really cool, right? And now here's the thing. Celsius or Bayer released Celsius, I think it's Celsius Extra, which is a new formulation they have that has, I don't know what the other active ingredient is, but the one failing of Celsius was that it didn't target POA. So I believe they've addressed that in that Celsius Extra will target POA. I don't know that if it still has as much coverage as Certainty Celsius, because like Certainty, in addition to killing POA, the biggest thing about Certainty is its sedge control. Like it will, I mean, nut sedge, yellow, purple, globe sedge, like pretty much anything with sedge in it, Certainty will knock it out. It will like absolutely just destroy it. I don't know if the new Celsius Extra has that coverage as well. I know it does POA, but I don't know about that. But yeah, I'm going to keep rocking the Celsius Certainty combo mainly because I've got it. And I want to say that I'm probably going to get at least better sedge control out of using that concoction than going to just a single product. So I'm glad to hear that it helped with knocking out the burrweed, Robert. Very, very cool. Very, very good stuff. Glad to hear that it was a fit. All right, and Left Tool. Of course, Left Tool. Of course, he says, all right, we are starting a Ron Kilt Fund. I'll tell you what, you know what? If you guys, I need to be careful, because if I say, here's the thing. If you guys start a Kilt Fund, I don't know. You know, I'm looking at Samuel L. in a kilt, and it doesn't look bad. I mean, I could do like a video in a kilt. I could do that. I could do something like that if you guys start like a kilt fun and decide that's what some of you guys really want to see. I think it's going to look horrible. Here's the thing. If we do a kilt, we got to have some ground rules. It's got to be below. Listen, I'm not that kind of guy. It's got to be like below knees. Don't be, you know, you're trying to sponsor any kind of Daisy Duke type kilts. None of that kind of stuff. We ain't doing that. It's got to be like a long kilt. Like if you look at like, you know, like what Sam L is rocking here. See that? That's below the knee. It looks maybe even longer than that. You know, like that length there we can work with. But nothing short. Because I know if I leave you guys to your own devices, Lord knows what will show up in my mailbox. So so we gotta lay some ground rules here on Ron and the Kilt Fun. But yeah, let's see. Papa Moslow, I'm gonna so regret this. Bob Moslow says, at Kilting in the Lawn, give him a follow on IG. All right. Yeah, man. If you guys, if he's a lawn care YouTuber and you guys want to give him some love, or IG, he's got an Instagram. Yeah, give him some love for sure. Thanks for that, Bob Moslow. Appreciate it. Appreciate that. Nom nom. Very good. All right, we have a question next from Andrew Phillips talking about a fungus problem. He says, hey Ron, every year I have an issue with green fungus around my air conditioner as a result of the condensation, and the concrete it sits on. Okay, so like fungus and moss, I guess. It also creeps into my grass. How do I kill it? Thanks. Okay, so here's the thing, Andrew. We can do a fungicide. You can do a fungicide to kill the fungus, but it's better than doing that is to resolve the problem. So we've already identified, based on what you're saying, that the issue with the green fungus, I'm imagining it's probably moss and or fungus, is due to water from the air conditioning unit settling in an area. So if there's something we can do as far to divert that away from the area so where it doesn't all settle and pool there, that's what I would focus on more so than like a fungicide. You got to be careful with that. If you increase the length of that drainage pipe, you don't want it to ever go uphill. You want to make sure it can always drain well, that doesn't get stopped up or any of these kinds of things. So you got to be really careful when it comes to, you know, as far as adding length to those pipes. But what I would focus on is improving the drainage so that you don't have water pooling in that area. Because can you go out and you can put down headway? Gee, sure. You could do that and it will treat it for, you know, 2-3 weeks, a month, and it'll kill the fungus and then it'll come right back. So better to help resolve the problem, start target the actual problem itself versus just treating the symptoms. Because one, fungicide is expensive and we have already identified what the root cause of the issue is. So I would focus on that. And then after you've done some things to improve drainage, then if you want to do a fungicide app afterwards to knock it, smoke it out, then sure that makes sense then. In that case, you know, I don't know what fungus you're dealing with, but headway is going to be a great option. But I would only do that after we've addressed the drainage problem. If you decide to go with headway, I will send you a link for Headway G. It's a great, great, great product. But again, I would not be putting this down in that area until you address the problem with drainage first. So great question. Sorry you're dealing with that. But here's a good thing. At least we know what's causing it. So now it's just to devise a plan to prevent the conditions that are causing the fungus issues. All right. And then when Jared's like, come on, Ron, we're the kilt Samuel Jackson did. I don't own a kilt, guys. I don't own a kilt and I'm not buying a kilt. So, you know, whatever. We'll see. You know, there's a couple of you guys that have that have a mailing address for me. So, I mean, and unfortunately, I think the lawn tools are one. And they're some of the worst ones to know because you guys, your sense of humor is different. We'll just say that. And we'll see. But like I said, if a kilt shows up, it can't be no Daisy Duke kilts. It's got to be a proper, you know, proper length kilt. Nothing crazy. All right. Next up, we have a Robert. He says, I sprayed it. Yeah, he sprayed it when he had 75 degree weather here in Central Alabama. So I guess last month, Robert. And that's the time to do it. So for a lot of you guys that have been asking questions about herbicide this time of year, you know, most of them are really going to work best when temps are warmer, right? Even Spectracide, even like, you know, the staple, the one I always recommend here to you guys all the time. Let's see here. Weed grass killers, lawn weed killers. Nope, wrong one. I always pick weed grass killers for some reason whenever I go here first. But like, for example, Orange Bottle, this guy, like the cheaper, like this guy, the Spectracide that's like offers very good coverage. Like it clearly says 45 to 90 degrees, like that, you know, that's the range, temp range you need for this stuff to work well. Celsius Certainty, again, because it is a more potent combination, like it's a more, like the concentration, you have more control over it as far as how strong concentration you mix up. You're likely going to get a better result with that, but it's still going to be slow. Still going to be slow. Like what Robert did was actually the way to do it. Wait for like a stretch of warm weather and then do your spray application then. You know, and he got a really good result with it. I think it'll still work. I mean, I've gone through the label a couple of times of both products, and I've not seen any guidance where it says, yeah, if you spray this when it's like 55 degrees outside, you're just not going to get a result. It's just said that 65 degrees or lower, the response is going to be a lot slower. So if you go into it knowing that, you can get a good result. You know, you can get ahead on the weeds. All right. Manchester Soul says, you seem pretty tall, Ron. The kilt might work well on you. So you're saying that I might carry a kilt well, Manchester? Is that what you're telling me? Well, I'm 6'4", so maybe, I guess. We'll see. I gotta work out, man. I gotta work on my calves. I mean, I got decent legs, but I gotta hit the gym, get the calves looking right. If I'm gonna be out there on camera in a kilt. Although most of my videos, you never really see my feet. It's always me like doing, you know, heads up, you know, from like a cowboy shot, from like the hip up. Although if I do a kilt video, we'll have to pan down a little bit so you guys can see me in the kilt. So we'll see. I don't think it's gonna happen, but you know, it's we can dream, right? We can be something to think about. Plus, we've already got a YouTuber or like the guy who's already the kilt. We already have like a lawn care kilt guy. I don't want to be stealing his thunder or taking his stuff. You know, that's his jam. So if I do it, it'd be like a one-time thing. It's not going to be a common thing that's going to happen on the channel. All right. Next up is Mr. Thin Cut. I think you said you work, you're like a, what would be the correct name? Like a butcher or someone that works in a meat market that works on carving up cuts of meat. I think sounds like a butcher to me. He says, hello, evening everyone. Hopefully everyone is doing well. I'm doing well. I think everyone else is doing well. Thanks for coming to hang out, Thin Cut. I appreciate you. And then next up, we have Brandon Tabilsma. And with a look at that bow. That is quite the bow, young lady. Whatever she's wearing, it's because you got that's a lot of bow she's rocking there in your avatar. Thanks for coming to hang out in the live stream, Brandon. I appreciate you. I think you're new to the chat. I think you're new to the live stream. If not, I think it's the first time I recall seeing your name. So if you're new, welcome. If not, I apologize for not remembering, but I'm pretty good with remembering the names of the people that show up in the live stream. At least for now, right? If the channel gets a lot bigger, then I'll start obviously not remembering everybody, but I think you're new. But at any rate, welcome. Happy New Year. All right. Next up, we have Victor Stams in the house. He says, Happy New Year, Ron. Happy New Year to you, Victor. He says, I saw your video on the T-Jet nozzle. I have used it and don't know that I love it. Okay. He says, if I have to use one nozzle for any droplet size, any other nozzles you'd recommend for the lawn? Here's the thing. That's a good point. So here's the thing, Victor. Before I really switched to the T-Jet nozzles, you guys know for years, I just used, I want to say it's a 25 degree. A lot of people call it the pressure washing tip nozzle, the one that the Flow Zone comes with and also the Yard Mastery sprayer comes with. Like I don't have it here. It's on the sprayer. But I used that for a number of years and got a really good result with that. If you are looking to get the most though out of your foliar apps, using like that 110 degree T-Jet nozzle is going to be better. It is going to be better because it creates a finer droplet size that just gets better coverage. It gets better coverage over the leaf, and you're just going to get better absorption by doing that. So really, you need two. You need the 110 degree, the one that you have that you sounds like you don't really like that much. Like that is the best for foliar apps. And then second, if for doing things like pre-emergent or any soil-based applications, one like this, like one of the air induction tips. And I've got one version or one variant here, like that guy, like this guy here. Like this is one you can do as well. Like this produces very, very large droplets and is very good for any products you're trying to get down in the soil to begin working. The big negative I'd say to me about the T-Jet nozzle, the foliar one, is if there's any kind of wind, like, or if you're having, you know, not say any kind of wind, but if it's an above average wind, like, you know, I don't know, 10 mile an hour wind, it's just really hard to keep the product where you want it to be. Whereas that's where going to another one that's in my video, like another nozzle I list in my video, an air induction tip. That kind of splits the difference. This nozzle produces very, very big droplets. The other nozzle I mentioned in my video is in between like the foliar nozzle and this guy. You could go to something like that and see if you like the results out of that more. But really, you want something like this, and then the foliar one. That's really going to get you the best result. So just don't be so quick to give up on it. Use it a bit more. Try it out a few more times and just see if you can get used to it, because it is a better way of doing it. I mean, I used to do, here's the thing. I'm a guy that I used to do the 25 degree for years, And again, you can get good results with them. I'm not saying that that won't work, but if you're truly trying to optimize things, then using one of the T-Jet nozzles is the way to go. All right. We have Alex chiming in. He says, at Victor Stamps, I really like the T-Jet nozzles I've used, which is often the general consensus. I'd say make sure it's a proper one of theirs that works best for the specific task. That's exactly right. So there's really two that you need. You can get a third one. So there's like, again, there's the Foliar, the really fine 110 degree tip, 110 degree spray tip. There is this guy, which is the very large droplet size, that guy right there. And then there's the one that's in between that, which is also an air induction tip, you know, so it just depends on which one you want to go with. So yeah. And Alex is saying, yeah, I have both the large and small droplet versions they make and switch them out as needed. So yeah, just, I would say just use it a little bit more, man. Give it a bit more time before you, you know, you throw in the towel on the T-Jet tips, because it is a better way of doing things. All right. Next up, we have Mr. G-Free in the house. He says, hey, Ron and Stripe Action Gang, what's going on? G-Free 301. Happy New Year. Hopefully you're doing well. Appreciate you coming to hang out in the live stream. All right, Vance Woods is here. He has a question about Poanua. He says, hey, Ron, I hope all is well. I am doing well. Can't complain. He says, can you remind me what I can do to knock down, I think you said Poanua, yeah, but Poanua grass that's sprouting throughout my dormant Bermuda grass. I thought I had it under control, but got whacked lately. Okay, so there's a couple of options, Vance. You can use, if you've not done pre-emergent, you can use a product called Coastal. I don't know if Do My Own has it back in stock yet. I need to reach out to them and see if they're actually planning on getting it back in stock. It's a really, really good product because it is both a pre-emergent and a post-emergent. So it's prodiamine as a pre-emergent and then imazoquin and simazine as post-emergent. So it'll prevent new growth of POA and it will kill existing POA. So that's Coastal. So that's an option if you've not done pre-emergent. So I'll put that as option one at Vance Woods. So this is Coastal. If all you're trying to do is take care of the POA, right? So you don't really care about pre-emergent, which you should, but if you've already done pre-emergent, you just had like some, you know, some POA breakthrough or something and you want to treat it. A good option is you could use Image. That's an option. Or you could use a product called Certainty. Certainty or Image, either one of those will work well against POA. Image is going to be a little bit slower to work. You're going to need to water it in. It's like one of its, like Image, the ingredient, active ingredient in Image, which I believe is imazoquin, that's taken up by the roots. So you need to water that product in for it to work properly. And then if you decide to go with Certainty, that is one where you're going to want to use a surfactant with it. That's a foliar app type product. So Certainty is going to work faster than Image, but either one of them you can get a good result with. So it just depends on which way you want to go. If you decide you're going to go with Certainty, I don't know if I have a link for that. Do I? I do. I've got both of them. Yeah. So I've got a link here for Certainty that you can try out as well. It depends on if you, how much work you want, because here's the thing with Image, you can get, let me see here at Vance Woods. I can talking and typing. This is hard. So there's Certainty. The thing with Certainty I say is this, right? You have to have a backpack sprayer to apply it. So that's the only, I'm not sure it's a negative, but it's a consideration, right? Like if you don't have a backpack sprayer, now you got another piece of equipment you got to go buy to be able to apply this product. Whereas Image, you can buy that at like your local Wally World, Home Depot, wherever, Lowe's, wherever you happen to go and buy your big box store. And they make it, and I don't have it inside the house here, but they make it in a like a ready to spray bottle. So you just hook it up to a hose and a sprayer and you can use that. So that's an easier way to go. It is not as fast working as Certainty. But if you're looking for easy, especially if you don't own a backpack sprayer as yet, that's an option. So Certainty or Image, if you're looking strictly just for a post-emergent, just to kill the POA. If you're looking for a post and pre-emergent, so you want to kill existing POA and prevent new POA from growing in, then see if you can find some Coastal. See if you can find it. I put a link in the chat there. I'm not sure if Do My Own has it in stock, but if you can find that somewhere, like that's going to be your like the best option, especially if you've not done pre-emergent as yet. So something to keep in mind. Hopefully that helps. Sorry you're dealing with POA. Get ahead of it. Don't let it get, because it spreads like wildfire if you don't get ahead of it. So hopefully that that helps. All right, next up we got Jim Carson in the house from SoCal saying, hey, we are finally getting rain in my dirt backyard. I'm getting mushrooms everywhere. I do not ever remember getting them back there. So my question is that a good thing or a bad thing? I don't worry about mushrooms really, Jim. So it's a sign of healthy soil. The few times when I get mushrooms, they tend to grow up. They tend to pop up in the morning. And by mid-morning, 10 o'clock, 10:30, 11, they're gone. As soon as any kind of heat hits, they burn off. And it's normally, for me, a warm weather, like a consistent warm weather, like a spring, summer type thing. Like even during the warm snap we had there during December, I didn't get any mushrooms in the lawn. So it's not a bad thing. I wouldn't worry about it. I would not go out trying to find products to try and kill it. I don't know that there's really that many products that are rated for residential use that will target mushrooms. And so I just wouldn't worry about them. I would not mess with them. It's a good thing. They're a good thing is what I'm trying to say. So I wouldn't look for any way to try and get rid of them. All right, next up we have Thin Cut. He says, I'm a proud dad. My son in California, unbeknownst to me, is into lawn care. He can't make the live stream, so I'm trying to pass on any advice to him. Unfortunately, he's going with cool season grass. Cool season grass, nothing wrong with that, man. I mean, you know, it's still grass. You can't hate on cool season grass. I mean, Augusta National uses cool season grass. You know, when we think about the Masters, what you're looking at is cool season grass for the most part, right? So cool season grass is still good stuff. All grass matters. All grass matters, even cool season grass. Even cool season grass. That's good, man. It's very cool that he's also into lawn care. Yeah? You know, I guess the apple doesn't fall far from the tree without you knowing it kind of rubbed off on him, right? It's like when you turn into your parents, you start mowing grass and mowing your lawn and, you know, start flower beds and all this kind of stuff. I haven't done the flower bed thing as yet, but yeah, lawn care is definitely one of those things. All right, next up, we have Gary Kettle Jr. in the house. Just Happy New Year, Ron. Happy New Year, Gary. Hope you're doing well. He says, watching you in a heated garage and my wife walked out and quoted BYD. Hey, yard fanatics, cold here in Chicago, 5 degrees outside. Yikes. I appreciate it, man. Yeah, BYD is, he's the OG, man. As far as like him and Doc, I guess as far as warm season turf, there's, I say this, as far as Bermuda goes, because obviously Alan is the godfather of all lawn care YouTube. And he has St. Augustine, which we will also accept as a warm season grass, you know, begrudgingly so, but we'll accept it. But yeah, BYD, Doc, and then myself as far as Bermuda goes. But yeah, I'm glad that even up in Chicago, at least we're doing something right, right? You guys, even your wife knows about us and our love for the lawn, which is very cool. So very, very good. Stay warm, man. Stay warm up in Chi-Town. All right, Girls Lawn's in the house. What's going on, Girls Lawn? Hopefully you're doing well. Looks like you changed up the avatar, man. Looks like I like it. I dig it. I like the new colors. Looks good. Looks good. I dig it. Looks really, really good. All right. Jim says it's in the 60s. And then Alex is saying I actually enjoy the snow and cold, not as much as lawn care, and don't mind removing it as long as the snowblowers are working. Here's the thing. It was actually in the 30s today when I was out mowing, and it was nice. It was pleasant. I mean, I don't want to sound like a wimp, but I wore double pants and then two t-shirts and then I had a hoodie on top of that. So I guess that probably sounds lame for you guys being like, you know, in the mid 30s, but it was nice. It was actually pretty nice. It was nice to mow and not sweat like crazy. So I can see it. I can see why some people would like cooler weather. Not me so much, but I get it. I can see the attraction, especially if you grew up with it. All right. Let's see. Left Tool says the Tahoma is in a very thick dormant status right now. Last year went dormant. Last year, this year, my neighbors stayed green an extra week or so, but I absolutely love it thick and soft. Very, very cool. So it's thick and dormant. Okay. So the Tahoma, and here's the thing, it's hard to say, right? Because you're in Arkansas, it gets way, way colder there than it does here. It'd be interesting to know if someone in Northeast Georgia has Tahoma 31 and just to see how it does, right? I mean, my lawn has stayed green. You know, the Arden has stayed green, you know, all throughout for most of the winter, or I should say a lot of it has anyway, but it's our climates, our weather is completely different. So it doesn't really mean anything, right? But it's cool. It's cool that it's doing well. Looks like it's in great status and great shape. Just falling asleep until springtime rolls around. You plan to change the height of cut next year? You're trying to take it any lower, taller, trying to do anything different? Be interesting. Inquiring minds want to know, sir. Inquiring minds want to know. Will Gaither. I'll allow it. I'll allow the Roll Tide roll because I can't, you know, I can't hate, you know. I mean, even people from Alabama that watch the show, I got to allow you guys to have your voices heard too. So I'm still pulling for Georgia, but I will say this. How about this, guys? How about this? And you know what? Hopefully there's not a bunch of people in the Big Ten in here watching, but I will just say the SEC this year definitely showed asserted dominance because you watched the Georgia game and the Alabama game, and it was like no contest. It just shows you how much high, and I'm not saying that like Ohio State's got a decent team sometimes, and so does like Notre Dame and whatnot, right? But I mean, if you compare the SEC this year compared to like the rest of the country, it's like not even close, right? Like we curb stomped those guys, man. It was not. I was proud of Georgia the way we did. Who did we do? We did Michigan, and who did Alabama play? Alabama played Ohio State. It's one of those teams up north that just got beat down. But anyway, it just shows like how much higher the standard of football is here in the Southeast. It's religion down here, right? Than up there. So very, very cool stuff. All right, let's see what other comments or questions we have. We got Henry Fitz in the house here with a question. Interesting one. He says, can pre-emergence be used at the same time as biochems like RGS and humic? So here's what I'd say, Henry. You want to mix the uptake method of any products that you're putting together. So pre-emergence need to be watered in. If anything you're putting down, like I guess RGS, I've never used RGS, so I can't really comment on it. And I'm not sure which humic product you're talking about. If you're talking about like some kind of a liquid humic product, I guess. If all of those should be root absorbed, so they all need to be watered into work. And if you can check them, like if you put them together in a jar, like do a jar test, get like a jar like this, a mason jar like this, put some water in it, put all the products you're talking about or considering mixing, and see, you know, mix them together and make sure they don't clump up or do anything crazy, they don't separate or stuff like that. Also check the labels for all the products, make sure that the labels don't have any restrictions around mixing. In mixing the products, some of them do, some don't. So I would say as long as they are all, like a good example, you would not want to mix something like, you wouldn't want to mix like a product, like a liquid FERT, like that's designed for a foliar application with pre-emergent. I mean, some people do it, but if you think about it, like the pre-emergent is designed to get down in the soil. The foliar liquid FERT is designed to stick to the leaf. So really, you know, you're kind of working against yourself because you ideally would spray the pre-emergent and then water it in, and you don't really necessarily want to wash the fertilizer off the leaf. So as long as you're matching like the way the product is designed to work and it passes a jar test and there's no guidance saying to not mix it with anything else, then yeah, you should be able to do that with no problem. Everything you listed there should work well together, but again, just test it. Like do a jar test, see what happens, and then and save yourself some work by not having to do multiple applications. Like do like pre-emergent in one backpack sprayer, then do another one with like your biostimulants. So yeah, good question. Hopefully that helps. All right. Next up, we have Mr. Jeremy White. Mr. Jiu-Jitsu is in the house. What's going on, Jeremy? He says, Happy New Year, big bro. Hope all is well. I am doing well. Cannot complain. He says, trying to become a complete martial artist. Started my journey in judo. Okay. Love it. Trying to add another layer with jiu-jitsu being my base. My lawn looks awesome. That's cool, man. Yeah. I mean, so judo. So here's the thing. You see, you're trying to be complete. So jiu-jitsu, yes, is like, you know, there's a lot of ground game. Judo, also, I mean, it's a lot of throws and also some ground game. Make sure you add like a striking art of some sort. Now, I mean, here's the thing. I get it. Like going from jiu-jitsu to judo, there's some overlap as far as, the styles are similar or more similar than say like what I do, which is tung sudo, which is more stand-up. It's more like taekwondo, more stand-up striking, right? So, So awesome, man. Like adding judo is obviously good, but also at some point add a striking art. Because here's the thing. Like fights, yes, they can end up on the ground, but nobody wants to fight on the ground. Because like judo works really well and jiu-jitsu works really well on a mat. But like if you have multiple people, like there's more than one person and you're on the ground, it's bad. Like, you know, you're like trying to roll with the one dude on concrete and his buddies are like curb stomping you. So you want to like fighting on your feet is in real world applications. You want to be on your feet as much as you can because it's just more of an advantage. You have more situational awareness. You don't get people, you know, putting a Nike up against the side of your head And it's just, just offers more options. Learn all of it, but also add a striking art, a stand-up striking art as well. So I recommend that while you're, starting to fill out your martial arts resume. Good stuff, man. I'm glad you're doing well. And thanks for the comment. Thanks for the comment. All right. Kevin D. Jones is in the house saying, hey, Ron, I am jonesing to cut and shopping for a real mower while watching. What is the advantage of having a real mower with a groomer? Okay. For most lawns, none. For most home lawns, absolutely none. There's not really an advantage to doing it. So a groomer really comes into the way. First of all, what a groomer is. A groomer is, some people set them up to try and do verticutting with them, but they're not designed to do that. What a groomer is designed for cutting golf greens. It's designed when you have like bent grass greens for any of like the grass that lays down. It's a way to cut those, to cut those little, the ones that are laid, the grass that's laying over, as well as standing it up to get a better cut. The height of cuts that they're designed to work at is really like 0.35 of an inch and shorter. Most home lawns, most people aren't maintaining their lawns that short. Really, you really need to be under 0.4 to get any benefit out of it. And even then, the general guidance is whatever your height. Let me make sure I'm getting this right. So whatever height of cut you're at, you want the groomer halfway between that. So let's use this example. Let's say, to make some math easy, let's say you're cutting at 0.40. It's still a bit high for a groomer, but say you're cutting at 0.4, you would set the groomer to 0.2. Right? So you wouldn't set it all the way. Like some people want to say they want to use it as a verticutter, but they want to get it to where it's really low, where it's almost like tickling the ground. And they're not designed for that. You're going to wear them out. You can potentially damage them. You're going to wear belts out faster. For most home lawns, for like 99.9% of people, it's not something that you would want. Most people that have them usually get them because the real mower they're able to find came with a groomer. And that's just what they bought, right? And a lot of them will either disable it or they'll raise them up really, really high to where they never come into play. So yeah, I actually did a video on that, believe it or not. Let me see if I can actually find it for you here super quick. I did a video that for, where do I go? I went to Stone Mountain Golf Course. They were super cool and allowed me to come out and do a setup for AccuGauge. I did a video for AccuGauge. On how to set up a groomer. So I've actually got an actual video on this. So if you're interested in seeing like what a groomer is, how to set it up, like all the, everything about it, I've got a video right here that I did last spring, Kevin, that will tell you all about them, why and when you'd want to use one. But the long short of it is for a home lawn, you wouldn't. I mean, here's where they would make sense. If you have your home lawn, but you also have like a putting green and you want to use a green, you're cutting it like every day and you really want it to look its absolute best, that's when having a groomer would make sense. But for your actual lawn, no. Not something you really need. So hopefully that helps. If you get a great deal on a mower and it comes with one, go for it, but don't pay extra to get a groomer because most people don't really use them, aren't cutting in a way that allows them to use them. So very, very cool. All right. Girls Lawn says, yes, burning the whole thing down. I'm considering a burn down. I just don't really want all that work. I'm not sure if you're talking to me or someone else, but whatever. Thanks for the comment. All right. Next up, so I can find it. We got, I guess, Rome, someone from Rome, Roma Roma, is in the house saying, what's up? And giving a thumbs up. I'm not sure. That's a cool looking, I'm sure it's really a golf course. It looks like a bunch of greens surrounded by a lake. Very, very cool. Cool avatar. Wherever it is, very cool picture. If you are from Rome, thanks for coming to hang out. A really good buddy of mine is from Italy. I think he's from southern Italy. I didn't realize this was a northern Italy, southern Italy thing, but I mean, he's Italian. Man takes his food super, super seriously. But yeah, if you're from Rome, thanks for coming to hang out and welcome to the live stream. Really appreciate you. And let's see what other questions or comments we have in the live stream. Guys, if you guys are enjoying the show and you've not yet given the live stream a like button, it's free for you guys to do. You can touch that like button ever so gently. It's a great way to support the channel. Allows me to take a sip of my official live stream cup, courtesy of Mr. Josh Habib. Thanks, Josh, as always. And it's a great way to support the channel. If you guys wouldn't mind doing that, I would really appreciate it. Thanks so much. Milo is really, really good. I mean, you know what? Milo is the kind of stuff you would drink out of a fine crystal glass. Like literally, it's that good. It's that good of lemonade. It's actually, so I'm gonna say it's criminal, because I mean, obviously this is a fine cup. This is a very, premium drinkware here. But I mean, this is not something that you would put, it's not something you would put in a, I don't think it's like red solo cup status. It deserves more than like a red solo cup, right? You got to kind of give it more love than that. All right. But yeah, as far as mowers, man, if you can find a Toro Greensmaster, I am partial to those. If you're looking for a greens mower, if you're looking for something that is one of the better all-around mowers, True Cuts you can't go wrong with. But you know, find out what you can get service in your area, and choose based on that. All right, Andrew Phillips is in the house again. We're on the Real Mower Talk. Andrew says, "Hey, Kevin D. Jones, I'm looking to purchase a Swarman Real Mower as my first Real Mower. I have learning to do to get used to Real Mowing." Very, very cool. Yeah, man. So here's the thing. One thing with Swarman, you got to be careful. I know Real Rollers used to carry them. I don't think that Real Rollers carries Swarman anymore. So I know they used to do a lot of really cool stuff for the Swarman community, as far as like that you could send your reel into them and they would like sharpen it and send it back. They had like a whole reel sharpening program. So, you know, just be careful, because there's less places that, Real Rollers was one of the bigger Swarman dealers, I think, in the country. And they also had like Lee, Eric, and Andrew, they're really good as far as like supporting the community. So I don't know if there's someone else that's picked up the slack on that. If not, because remember, Swarman is made overseas somewhere. Just be careful. You know, there's lots of great options. If you've got your heart set on a Swarman, go for it. But just keep that in mind. Make sure you've got a good way to get parts and a good way to get the reel of the mower taken care of. Because I don't believe Real Rollers is doing that anymore. So just something to keep in mind. You know, again, I'm partial towards True Cut, which is, as I've already said already in the live stream. But yeah, all Real Mowers are cool. But something to keep in mind, Andrew, while you're on your hunt for a Real Mower. Okay, on the subject of Real Mowers, you got Austin B. in the house. He says, "I broke down and ordered the new Alette Sterling." Okay, we got to clap it up for that. Congrats. I don't know what the new Sterling is. I guess I'll have to do some research. I've not heard of that one as yet, but yeah, I guess let us know how it works out once you get it, Austin. Hopefully it does everything that you're hoping and more. And very nice, looks like a Corvette. Nice vet, man. I like it. Very cool. Love the styling on those. They're really, really, really cool cars. Chevy went above and beyond on those. So congrats on the relatively new ride, because they're new, and congrats on the new Real Mower. Hope it works out well for you. All right, Jim Carson, like me, is also drinking Milo's lemonade. As well. All right. And our next question is from Heartfelt Fashion. So we're now like in a True Cut segment or a mower segment, which I like. I dig it. He says, "Hey there, Ron. I'm thinking about getting a True Cut 27 inch. What do you think?" What do I think? I think it's an excellent option. I think it's a, so here's the thing. The 27 inches is one of the more common ones to find, especially if you're going pre-owned. The only thing I would say is, if you have a 27-inch, make sure that it will fit in all the areas that you need to mow. So if you have any tight areas, like in my case, I have a swale, the swale between Alex's lawn and my lawn. Like in my case, the 25-inch is what I decided to go with for that area, because the 27 is just a bit too wide. Like the Greensmaster can't get in there, and a 27-inch True Cut also can't get in that area. So in my case, the 25-inch is a better fit. Now, if that's not the case for you, where 27, you know, you've just got a big open lawn, big open field, and you don't have any big obstacles to mow around, you don't have any areas where you need like a slightly narrower cutting width, then the 27 is a great way to go. I mean, as far as finding reels, I mean, you can obviously get reels for any of them, but I mean, as far as like, say you need like a grass catcher, or you need anything that's specific to the 27, like those are a lot more common than the 25. Like 25s I want to say the 25s are probably the least common. Like you see a lot of 20 inch True Cuts, and you see the 27 inch ones. You don't see a lot of the 25s. But I mean, you know, if you're in the north, if this area, Northeast Georgia, doesn't really matter. There's True Cut dealers all over the place. Getting parts is not a problem. But yeah, if you decide to go with the 27 inch and your lawn and obstacles in your lawn are such that cutting width is the way to go for you, then go for it. I mean, it saves you less passes and wider stripes. So can't go wrong with it. I think that's a great, great idea. I would do that in Heartfelt Fashion. And we'll just give you congrats ahead of time. And if you're going to shop for one, get it now. Like, don't wait until March, April rolls around when everybody and their grandmother is going to start to decide they're going to take up real mowing. Like, get it now. Get it when there's not a ton of demand for it. One, if you're getting a pre-owned one, you're going to be able to have a bit more negotiating power because anyone that's selling one right now, there's not as many people looking for them. And you're just going to have more options. So I would get it now versus waiting too late into the spring to shop for one. Something to keep in mind. All right, Mr. Courtney's in the house saying, blessings, Ron, March is just around the corner, can't wait. Yeah, man, dude, hey, the way things are going, we not might not need to wait till March, right? It might be February, late February, we're out there mowing. I was out there mowing today, but I mean, you know, as far as like a mass green up, it might be sooner than we think. Again, that's what my front lawn looks like as of this morning, you know, so who knows? Who knows? Let's look at the weather and see what happens. See what happens. Kilting in the Lawn has a question about gypsum. He says, does gypsum really help break down clay soils? Here's the thing, Kilting. I've never applied gypsum to my lawn to be able to tell you for sure as far as if it has an effect on clay soils, how well or how fast it would. However, I can point you to a video of someone that absolutely is going to know the answer to that question. There's the nice folks at Soil Lab, like the people that make the My Soil test kits. You guys know the soil test kit that I love. Shameless plug. Got to pay the bills though, right? So the guys that make this, the Soil Lab, the My Soil test kit, they have a YouTube channel where they cover all kinds of really cool topics around mulching versus bagging, you know, adjusting soil pH in alkaline and acidic soils. And what effect gypsum has on the soil. They have a great video on that. And I'll put that here in the chat for you so you can check it out if you want. You know, those guys do a really, really good job. They make a topic that can be, that's really complicated, but they make, you know, a topic that someone can easily take liberties with and make it sound a lot more complicated than it needs to be. Very easy for the average layperson to understand. So check that video out. Also check out the other videos from Soil Lab. Subscribe to their channel while you're there. They're a really good group of guys. They put out an amazing soil test kit. I love these things. They're awesome. And a lot of the content they put out is really good as well too. I think today they released like another follow-up video on testing a lawn and they cut it in half and they mulched half of it and they bagged half of it. And they were doing tests, collecting soil samples from both sides and are measuring the nutrient level based on whether you mulch or bag. So they do that kind of stuff that you wouldn't normally do on your lawn, right? So check that video out. That should help answer your question. And I think that will help out. Great, great stuff. All right. Mr. Courtney Slice says, come on, y'all. Country Time lemonade is the best. I don't know, man. That powder lemonade. I'm not going to go with you on that one. I've had Country Time. I've had Pink Minute Maid lemonade also comes like in an oatmeal container, right? The powder stuff. But yeah, it's not like this is premium vintage here, man. Like I said, this could come in a glass bottle or you could drink it out of a fine crystal glass. It is that, as far as lemonades go, it's that good. Great, great stuff. All right, next up we have a Heartfelt Fashion question about the Earthway spreader. It's a good question. This is a good one. He says, or she says, do you have any trouble out of your Earthway spreader with a full tub? My wheels are inflated 30 PSI. That's good. You're up there. It says halfway full tub and it pushes great, but not when it's full. I don't have any issues with that, Heartfelt. Like literally today, if you guys have not checked out my YouTube stories, where's my phone? Right here. If you check out my YouTube stories, in addition to showing you guys the lawn after I cut it and showing you guys me applying the Essential G, I actually like did a couple of passes where I actually videoed the Essential G flowing through the Earthway. And the thing is, whenever I refill this, the hopper, so obviously the first time it's just only one bag in there, but once I get down to like a third, I put another bag in. So it's like almost, it's not running over obviously, but it's as full as I can get it. And I don't have any problems with it flowing, with any product flowing out of it or anything like that. So no, I've not experienced that. The only issue I've ever experienced with the Earthway is there's a cotter pin. So if you look at your Earthway spreader if you're behind it on the right wheel, you'll see like a cotter pin that goes through. And if that ever breaks, you're going to lose drive. Like it's going to stop working. Or if it gets twisted and it starts, as the axle's turning, if it's nicking the frame, like that can cause it to be a little bit harder to push. But on a new spreader, especially if the like little tangs are bent back properly, none of those things should be an issue. But yeah, no, to answer your question, I've not experienced any problems with pushing the spreader or with product flowing out of the spreader based on how full or not full it is. From full all the way to empty, it flows really well. So yeah, so I mean, I guess send me an email if there's anything else I missed. I'll do my best to help you out. But yeah, it's a great spreader. This is why, like, literally last year, I bought the exact same model. Like, I could have bought like a Lesko or one of the other, you know, one of the high dollar, super high dollar ones. And I literally took my old one, I gave it to Alex, and I bought the exact same thing for my lungs. I like them that much. I think they're a perfect prosumer level spreader. So hopefully that helps. All right. Jim's laying ground rules. Says kilt ground rules, no leaf blowers. I'll drink to that.
Mm-hmm.
No leaf blower videos if we are wearing the kilt. No one wants to see that, right? No one wants. I can, you know, the thing is, I can wear Speedos underwards just in case. You know, that way we don't have any like wardrobe malfunctions. You know, you don't have to avert your eyes. We can do that. How about that, right? I wear Speedos underneath just to be safe. No, we're good to go. All right, yeah, Andrew, if it's moss you're dealing with, yeah, we're going to want to go. You're going to definitely want to eliminate, do something about the drainage or help correct the drainage prior to doing any kind of fungicide or any anything to kill the moss. You know, let's fix the problem before we start throwing products at it to try and kill it off. Okay, next up we have... Phi Dip is in the house. There's a question about, I guess, Dimension 1907. He says, I picked up some Lesko Dimension 1907 pre-emergent last summer on sale, but I'm not sure when in the spring I should apply it. I'm not sure. He's like, what does BO stand for? I'm not sure. Body odor? He says, I'm not sure when I should apply it. The high nitrogen content, I'm near Atlanta. Any suggestions? Yeah, given it's a 1907, I would wait until February, late Feb. Late Feb is when I would do that. Late February, early March. Like that formulation could almost substitute for your spring fertilizer app. That's kind of what I'm thinking that Lesko is going for with that formulation. So it's got some nitrogen and a bit of potassium to kind of kickstart the season. So I would just wait until you're ready to do, I mean, don't wait too late, but late February, early March is when I would go for that. When the grass is starting to grow is when you could do the application. So yeah, that's when I would do it. Not now. Don't do it now because the grass is not actively growing. So don't do it this time of year. And of course you would, Lois. You're like, you're voting to see Ron in a kilt. Of course you would. You guys supposed to be backing me up, man. Supposed to be backing me up. You guys trying to get me into a kilt? Oh no, would not be pretty. All right, Alex B is talking about the new mower. Says, is that one of those new battery versions? I have a slightly older Alex Kensington that my father gave me when he started hiring out his lawn care. Yeah, I'm not sure anything about the new one that he mentioned. Is it the Sterling, whatever it's called? Yeah, I don't know. I'll have to look it up. All right, a question here we have from NASCAR for Life says, do you know if you could mix a herbicide with an insecticide to do one app together? For example, Celsius with Bifen IT. Thanks, Ron. Check the label. So here's the thing with Celsius, you really want to use a non-ionic surfactant with it. So I don't know with bifenthrin, if you're going to want to like what would happen if you mix surfactant along with that. So check the label. I think if you're just dealing with a product that, that didn't need any of the adjuvants, nothing like a surfactant, I'd be more inclined to try that, but I don't know how bifenthrin is going to work if you mix it with Celsius with something like high yield sticker spreader. So check the labels. Check the labels. That's always going to be my answer, right? So check the labels to see that there's no guidance against not up against doing that. That's thing one, and then test it. Like get a mason jar, do a jar test, make sure that nothing crazy happens as far as separation or gelling or anything weird. And then if you want to give it a shot, go for it, you know? So, but I would check the labels of both products first to see if there's nothing restrictions. If there's not, jar test it and then you can go from there. I've not heard of anyone doing that though. I'm not saying it can't be done, but I've never heard of anyone doing Celsius and bifenthrin. Not heard of that one. Doesn't mean it can't be done, but I've not heard of it. Let us know. Try it out and let us know. Okay. And then when Chair's like, this is Ron, those the tool guys will have you in a tutu. I know, that's what I'm saying. That's why I had to put the qualification in there. They'd send me like some Daisy Duke, some kind of Daisy Duke type kilt or some kind of craziness. So I guess I'm saying it's gotta be like a traditional length kilt, like below the knee, like a regular kilt, you know, nothing too crazy. Because I know how they get down. I know how Jordan and how they will do. Vance, I appreciate that, Vance. Vance is like, I will not be donating to your kilt fund. I appreciate that because I really don't want to wear one. But hey, I'll be a good sport. If you guys come up with an idea for one and with one, then I might do that. Maybe. All right. Beast Like Blake is in the house. So the question is, says, hey, I just bought a house. Yard has rocks, lots of red dirt. Any recommendations for getting rid of the sticker burr? So like the burr weed. Yes, actually, I do have a suggestion on that. Another viewer in the live stream, Mr. Robert Rainey, was dealing with burr weed, much like you, and he used the concoction that I was talking about over like late summer, which is a combination of Celsius and Certainty. He got really good results with that. Now, here's the thing, Beast Like Blake, you're going to want to have temps a bit warmer than they, I don't know where you are, but I'm assuming, let's say you're in Atlanta, say you're my neighbor. You'd want temps to be a bit warmer than they are now, just before spraying that concoction. But it, you know, we've got someone that tried it out and they had really good results with it. And I've got a video actually showing you how to mix, how to apply all of that fun jazz. If the YouTube guy, yeah, there we go. I found it. Here's the video. So I'll find the link to it here and I'll post it in the chat for you. In that video, in the description, you'll find links for Celsius and for Certainty and the sprayer that I use and like literally everything and the surfactant, like all that stuff's all going to be in there. So just check out this video and it will get you on the right track as far as using that to help take care of burr weed. Again, I would wait. I don't know where you are in the country, you didn't say, but I would wait until temps are a little bit warmer before you use that concoction. You know, again, Robert did it when temps were like in the 70s and we had that stretch of weather. So something to keep in mind. Hopefully that helps. Appreciate the question. Thank you for being a viewer. All right. Jim Carson says, for Cavs, play some tennis. Yeah, man. Here's the thing. I used to play a lot of tennis when I was younger, believe it or not. I used to play a lot of tennis. I used to play tennis like I mowed grass. Like every, like 4 or 5 days a week, I'd be out. I would play tennis. So I used to play a lot, but not these days. That's when I was like a teenager. I used to play a lot of tennis. There's a tennis court in like the housing community that I grew up in on the island. So yeah, we play a lot of tennis. All right, 456 Bucci is in the house saying, hello guys, what's going on, Bucci? Hopefully you're doing well. And I appreciate that, Daryl. It's giving me a chance to sip my lemonade and remind everyone. So there's several ways to support the channel. Of course, you can always, if you're interested in getting like some more, you know, dedicated instruction, as well as being able to get access to the Facebook group. There's a Golf Course Lawn Academy available at golfcourselawn.com. That is obviously one option. Of course, now we now have channel memberships, which you can join, which is a way for you to, on a monthly basis, make a small contribution to the channel to help pay for lemonade, you know, gas for the mowers, lights, you know, all this stuff. Here's the thing, guys. You guys may not realize this, but like, you know, this production value, it costs. It's not cheap. Like having multiple cameras and all this kind of stuff, it's not inexpensive to set all this stuff up. So any kind of support that I can get, I would very, very much appreciate it. But if all that is too much, there's always the like button. And that is free. So if you touch the like button ever so gently, it's a great way to support the channel. It doesn't cost you anything. And it's still a great way to show your love and support for the live stream. Mm-hmm. All right. Next up is Stan G says, hey, everyone. I've been away for a while, but I'm back. And you guys ever watched Poltergeist as a kid? I could not sleep for, I want to say like weeks after watching that movie. I watched it when I should not have been watching it. I was way too young. And for anyone that's probably under the age of 35, you probably don't know what I'm talking about as far as Poltergeist goes. But yeah, welcome back, Stan. Glad you're back. Coming to hang out. Appreciate you. Glad you're doing well. And then Manchester says, someone who frequents these chats has to have a kilt hanging around to center on. Not necessarily. You know, not in, you know, in my size, I try to get it tailored to make sure it fits well. Because I'm not going to have a kilt that is ill-fitting. It's got to be well-tailored and, you know, fit well. So even if you got one laying around, doesn't mean that it's necessarily going to fit well. All right, thin cut. Here we go. Now, I'm about to get schooled. See, I suggest that he was a butcher. He says a butcher. I got to use air quotes. A butcher cuts up sides of beef, which I've done, into primal, and then into what you basically buy in a store. A meat cutter, which I think is what you are, I think you said a meat cutter, cuts up primal cuts into what you buy. Basically, the heavy lifting is done. Okay, so butchers like more is like a more, I guess the more rough, like the initial rough phasing, and then the meat cutter is like what ends up going into the packaging that we buy, like in the cooler, I guess, is if I'm understanding you right. I think that's what you're saying. If not, let me know, correct me, but I think that's what you're telling me, Thin Cut. I believe so. All right, next up we have Heartfelt Fashion and says, I have my neighbor's yard to do now, so I had to get that Flow Zone Typhoon 2.5 for Christmas. Very nice. Says, the wife got me the perfect gift. I had a pump backpack sprayer last year. Dude, nice. Very nice upgrade. Wifey loves you, man. That's a serious gift. And the 2.5, I believe, is the, it is, okay, I like my, just my tool, my dual pressure switch, like the two settings switch that I have. I think the 2.5 is what they should have done instead of doing the potentiometer. So I think I want to say with the 2.5, you still have, I think, what is it, five or six different pressure settings, but there are stops on it. So you know exactly when you're setting the same pressure each, you know, so you can be consistent. With a potentiometer, you never really know you're setting the same pressure each time. So I think the 2.5 was a good idea. You know, and again, if you've already got that, so roll with that. But then again, the Yard Mastery is also very good as well. So either one of those are great options. Congrats on the gift. It's a pretty awesome gift, and you're all set to go. While you're waiting for the springtime to roll around and break out the new spreader, be sure to get yourself some T-Jet tips. Get yourself like an adapter, and get yourself like a foliar tip and a larger droplet, like an air induction tip, so you're good to go. You want to get that stuff now before springtime rolls around and everyone and their grandmother's trying to get them. So you want to get ahead of it. But again, congrats on the spray. We can clap it up for that. It's a pretty cool gift. Pretty awesome. Good job to Wifey. I'm hooking you up. All right. Yeah. And Alex is B's chiming in saying you have the Yard Mastery sprayer waiting to come in back in stock and then jumping on that. Very, very cool. And then Nestor AS says, careful, Ron. Tall turf type fescue is the true alpha grass. Okay. All right. Okay. I mean, you know, everyone's entitled to their opinion. All right. If you say so. I mean, it looks nice. I don't know about true alpha, but it does look nice. I will say that tall fescue does look good. It's not Bermuda alpha, but it looks, you know, for a cool season grass, not bad. Well, how about that? We'll say for a cool season grass, not bad. We'll just say that. All right. Lavendi says, what's the final word on coastal in your experience? Asking for St. Augustine path, grass. I love it, man. It's pretty awesome. I mean, look at my, here's my lawn in coastal. So you want to see what my thoughts are? You tell me. This is the back lawn. And do you see any weeds? I mean, and it's been relatively warm weather over the entire, you know, up to now. Well, now we're starting to get cooler weather, but if you look, you see any weeds in the back lawn? None there. And if you look at the front lawn, again, I'm just not, this is just a picture, but there's no, I can assure you, there's no weeds anywhere throughout that. And the neighbors around me, well, not Alex, but there's other neighbors that have weeds in their lawn. So it absolutely works. I mean, it's, I am a fan of it. I am a fan of it. And I think for the price, it's hard to beat, right? You get the Primine and then you have the two post-emergents. So I think it's, you know, it's a great product. Like in my testing, my results so far have been really good with it. It's something I'm going to do. Because Alex did Dimension over the fall, I'm thinking we're going to do coastal on his lawn here, if not late this month, early next month. That's what we're going to do on his lawn for his spring pre-emergent. You know, he did Prodiamine last year, worked really well. No reason to not run it back again, right? So why not, instead of just using straight Prodiamine, we're going to spike it, put a little bit of something in there, use coastal, right? So to knock out any little weeds that are there in the process. All right. Oh, Cincinnati. That's right. That's who they played. Cincinnati. Yeah, that is who Bama put the beat down on. So yeah, very cool. Very cool. You guys, man, you don't know. How can you remember who we beat? But yeah, Cincinnati. I knew it was not Ohio State. I knew it was a team in Ohio, and I knew it wasn't Ohio State, but I forget. So, All right. Next up, we have Lavendi. Says, my HOA is bothering me about weeds. Not sure what to put down that'll work in North Florida now. Depends on the weeds you're dealing with. If you're getting a warm spell, you could try Spectracide. Again, it really works better with temps above 45 degrees. If you have a backpack sprayer, that Celsius Certainty combo, again, especially if the temps are a little bit warmer, is a great option. But anything you apply with temps being cooler is going to work slower. So just to know, just realize that. So as long as you go into it knowing that it's going to take a little bit longer for it to work, for you to see the result, you should be good to go. At least then you're putting forth an effort, right? You can at least say, hey, listen, I sprayed herbicide. It's going to be a while because it's like cold right now, so it doesn't work as well. And they'll be like, hey, at least Lavendi's trying. He's trying to get rid of the weeds. So there you go. All right. You're very, very welcome, Jim. No problem at all. Okay. Josh Bronco says, Ron, what cameras do you use for these crisp live streams? So I have two cameras. Well, I own three, but this is my photo camera that you're seeing here. So the camera that you're watching me on right now, which is the B cam, this is a Sony A1, the Alpha 1, with a 35 millimeter G Master lens. So I think this is at F1.8. So not wide open because there's too much light in here. But A1 with the, again, with 35 millimeter lens. And actually, no, I lie. Is this the 20? This is 24. I think. Yes. This is the 24 millimeter prime. So the 35 is behind me. So yeah. So this is the 24 millimeter prime. Again, at like, I think it's F1.8. That's the A1. That's the B cam. That's the backup, the second cam. The camera you're looking at now, which is my main camera, which is what you see in most of the YouTube videos. I actually take this outside, is an FX6. So this is their cinema, out of their cinema line. So an FX6 with their cinema lens. This is like an F2.8, 16-35. So it's a very, very nice setup. Like, that's what I tell you guys. Y'all need it. Like, I need the super chats and like the channel memberships and any other ways you guys want to support the channel, because again, I'm using really good stuff to try and put together as good production quality as I possibly can. But yeah, both these cameras run into dedicated capture cards, into Thunderbolt 3 capture cards, which is why everything looks like you don't see a lot of artifacts or anything like that. So that's it's a very, very good setup. And then the mic, everything's all top notch. But yeah, an FX6 with a cinema lens, and then a A1. And this guy's got like a zoom on it, so you guys can see. I can pull back. That's what in here looks like as I pull back. This is like a powered zoom lens. So this is what you guys are mainly looking at anytime you watch my YouTube videos outside. It's got like built-in NDs and all that fun stuff. So hopefully that helps. It's much more fun to make content when you have good gear that works with you, where the gear just gets out of the way and just makes it easier to be creative. I appreciate the question and the comment, Josh. All right, next up you have Dalvin Larry. He says, hey, Ron, I applied pre-emergent in October and deployed shortly after. She did October shortly after. Okay. Just got back last week. Zero weeds. Now we gotta say that again. I'm going to read that again because I always talk about the importance of pre-emergent. I'm going to read this comment again because it bears repeating. It says, hey, Ron, I applied pre-emergent in early October. That's the right time of year to do it. Late September, early October. Good timing. Deployed shortly after, just got back last week, zero weeds, and just want to say thanks for all your help last season. No problem at all, sir. Really, I offered suggestions, but you did it. But I mean, that's a great testament to, you know, a well-timed pre-emergent application. So I'm glad to hear that you don't have to deal with any weeds, Dalvin, because it becomes a cycle, right? So like if you do a fall pre-emergent to where you don't have a lot of weed pressure this time of year and also into the early, like late winter, early spring. And then when you do your spring pre-emergent, you're also lessening the chances of having weed problems in the summer. So pre-emergent twice a year is really all you need, coupled with like a good mowing practice, regular mowing, to have a great looking lawn. Like it's the only time you really need to be using herbicide on most lawns to keep them looking, keep them looking good. So I'm glad to hear that worked out well for you, Dalvin. Good stuff. And I'm glad you made it back safe from deployment. Appreciate you and thank you for your service, sir. And this next season is only going to be better, right? Because you got the weeds under control already. All right, let's see what other questions, comments we have. And then Jay the Work 09 says, what type of grass do you have and which pre-emergent did you use? And Dalvin is answering with Prodiamine at full rate following Ron's pre-emergent video. Yeah, so the video he's talking about And believe it or not, you guys didn't realize how much grief I got from people like saying, you've seen these like full. And I gotta do my haters. Hang on. Get all high pitch. You shouldn't use full rate pre-emergent because it's wrong and it's stupid and I would never do that and it just never works. I don't understand why anyone would ever do like a full rate pre-emergent app. It's just wrong. That's what they sounded like. And then like we did it on Alex's lawn. He has no problems with weeds in his lawn, and Dalvin did in his lawn. He has no problem with weeds in his lawn. So, you know, I'm not saying it's the only way, but I like easy. Like, you know, split apps are a thing. You can do that. There's nothing wrong with doing a split app, but it's more work. It's like more work. Like you got to get out there twice and do it, like spray pre-emergent, when like literally one time can work very well. Can work very, very well. So the video that he's referring to at JWork is, let me see if I can find you. JWork, are you still in here? Yeah, you are. Yep. This is the video on pre-emergent that I did about a month from now, this time last year. It talks all about how to mix it and how to apply it and all that fun stuff. So check that out. Prodiamine, you can get it. Again, shameless plug, gotta pay the bills. You can get it at the Golf Course Lawn Store. There's links in the description for that video. If you have a smaller lawn, like 6,000 square feet or less, and you have Bermuda, you can save yourself some money and just get one of these guys. These are like $21, $22 on the store, I think. $21, I think is what these go for. And this will do you for an app. So as long as you got like 6,000 square feet or less, one of these guys. If you have more than that, or you just want to, you know, you want to pay a bit more, but get actually a lot better, like lower your cost per app, then there is the 5-gallon tub, which we also sell in the Golf Course Lawn Store. But yeah, just check out the video I just put in the description. And in the links for that video is everything you need. The sprayer, pre-emergent, how to mix it, like everything. The measuring containers, all that fun jazz. So hopefully that helps. Glad that you got good results, Dalvin. And thanks for the question, JWork. And Dalvin, he's got that celebration Bermuda. He's got that Milo's Lemonade Bermuda. He's got that good stuff. Not like us, you know, us unwashed with like our Tiffway and, you know, Arden 15. He's got like, you know, the upper crust Bermuda celebration. Mm-hmm. I dig it. All right. Let's see what other questions we have. We're winding down. It's a good live stream tonight, guys. It's pretty good. See, I'm still waiting to get to my fruit. It's just sitting here waiting for the show to be over, but I got to answer all the questions first before we do that, right? Got to answer all the questions first. Let's see what other questions. Yeah, so Kevin D says, Andrew Phillips, Uncle Ron just dropped a gem. I'm going to do a top dress and true cut, which would be the same price and better benefit versus assortments. Yeah, so there you go, man. I'm not hating on Swordman, because a lot of people have Swordmans and love them, but with Real Rollers not carrying them anymore, and because I know the guys that work there and how they are and how they are about customer service, like, more, it's almost like anything else, right? Like, you think about it, like, what's when someone buys like an exotic car, like, what's one of the worst things they always say? It's not so much the price of the car, because they have the money to do it, it's the maintenance, right? It's like, do you have a dealership that's nearby that has a good service department that you're going to want to work with? They're not going to gouge you. They're not going to be terrible to have to, you know, be part of your life. When you buy a real mower, it's like starting a relationship, because I mean, they last a lot longer if they're cared for than rotary mowers. They are going to need maintenance. Like, they are going to need regular maintenance. Like, at least once a year, you're taking them in for a sharpen and a little freshen up. So you want to make sure that there's, you know, you've got a partner, you've got like a service shop nearby or some way to get the equipment taken care of. So, you know, yes, it's very cool to be able to say, yeah, I'm going to buy what all these other YouTubers are buying and whatever. But I mean, really, you're the one that's got to live with it. So fine, buy, like my, even though I love TrueCut and I love my Toro Greensmaster, I always say you should buy a real mower based on what you can get parts for and get serviced in the area you're in. That's the most important criteria. And to Kevin's point, you know, you can get a used TrueCut for under $1,000. You know, $1,000 is like one in pretty good shape, really good shape with a front roller. And then take the additional $2,000 that you didn't spend on the Swordman, and you can top dress your lawn and do a bunch of other stuff. Like, literally, that's your entire like budget, you know, that's a really, really nice lawn care budget for the rest of the season. So just something to consider. I mean, nothing wrong with a Swordman, but if you're in the market, I wouldn't be just, you know, really, you know, hell bent on it must be that, you know, especially with Real Rollers not really doing as much with them as they used to. So something to consider. I mean, your choice, but just something to keep in mind. All right. A. Josh Transport says, I have St. Augustine and Bermuda competing. What should I do to encourage one over the other? Cut less or more? Okay, so you should cut shorter. If you're trying, well, it depends. If you're trying to keep the Bermuda, if you're trying to keep the St. Augustine, heaven help. If you're trying to get rid of the Bermuda, heaven help you, because it's not going to happen. If you want the Bermuda to be the dominant grass and you're trying to hurt the St. Augustine, cut shorter. Like Bermuda, like it tolerates being cut much shorter cutting heights than St. Augustine does. So that's a way to encourage growth in the Bermuda while also stressing the St. Augustine. There's also, I mean, again, if you're trying to keep the Bermuda, there's lots of herbicides you can spray that are selective that will not damage Bermuda. Like you could do quinclorac. You can do, there's a lot of herbicides that frankly, that will kill crabgrass. Not that St. Augustine is crabgrass. Not that St. Augustine is crabgrass. I did not say that. But a lot of herbicides that will kill crabgrass will also damage St. Augustine and in most cases are also safe for Bermuda. So if the Bermuda is the one you want to keep, you can spray selective herbicides that will damage the St. Aug. And then also for your mowing practices, mow the Bermuda shorter. That's also going to help encourage Bermuda and also stress the St. Augustine. So between those two things, you're going to give the Bermuda a competitive advantage. It's still going to take a while to get rid of the St. Aug, but those are some things you can do that will help help accelerate the process if that helps. Good question. It's a good one. All right. So Jose Amade says, "Oh, don't you did you do did you did not you didn't do it." He says, "So I joined the bandwagon and I ordered grass paint. Also, I used the rotary scissors and oh my god, game changer! Best thing for Bermuda on trimming around flower beds and fences." Here's the thing: I've never seen the whole grass paint thing done well. I mean, I'm sure it can be done. I mean, there probably are sports fields that do it, but obviously they have like calibrated sprayers and they know what they're doing and it looks even. But every time I've ever seen one done on a residential lawn, one, the green doesn't look like the right color. The green looks off, and then you tend to see issues where when you're spraying where it overlaps, you have some really dark areas and lighter areas. I've never seen it done well. Not saying it can't be done well, but I've never seen it done well. Plus, it also, I mean, isn't it like you're kind of perpetrating a fraud a little bit, right? You're kind of making, you're trying to assert domination, but you're not really dominating because you're spraying the lawn green. So something to keep in mind. Just a thought. But I mean, if you do it, Jose, and you pull it off and it looks awesome, send me pictures. I want to see because I've not seen one done well. I would like to see one done well. So if you do tend to decide to spray your lawn, send me a picture, ron@golfcourselawn.com. If you're fine with it, we'll show the pictures on the live stream, maybe next week if you send pictures. And maybe yours, you're going to be the exception. You're going to be like, hey, look, this is one done right. So it can be done. And as far as the rotary scissors, I keep hearing really good things about them. I don't own one, mainly because I figure it's another piece of equipment that I'm going to have to take care of and maintain. And from hearing them online, they seem to be really loud. So that's the one thing, other concern that I have. But I've not heard anyone that's used one that's complained, say they didn't do a good job. The only thing I've heard is that really it's just the noise. But I'm not surprised that you really like it. Send me pictures, man. Send me pictures of the painted lawn. I'd like to check it out. I'd like to paint. I'd like to paint it out. I'd like to check out how it looks. All right. Next up, Gary Kellett Jr. is in the house. He says, "Hey, Ron, just ordered CK stress reducer. My question: should I use this? You said I use it this spring to jumpstart my yard. Yeah, sure. Yeah, absolutely. So like a little bit of sea kelp. Absolutely. Not a bad addition to your program. As the lawn's going to be waking up. I mean, what I'm going to be using, I'm not going to be using that product. I'm going to be using NutriKelp from the nice folks at Miramichi Green. Like this is 24, how much percentage is this? It is 24%. I think it's 24%, 24%, 25%, 24% kelp extract. So this stuff I've had awesome results with. It's also part of the Golf Course Lawn Carbon Kit. This is what I will be using, which is along the lines of what CK Extra, the stress reducer is. But this is part of like a package that I put together with Miramichi Green that contains the Release Zero, the NutriKelp, and a microbial package called BioSpectrum. So that's what I'm going to be using this spring. But yeah, absolutely. If you've already got that and you want to roll with that this spring, go for it. By all means, should get really good results with it. All right, next up, we got a question from Sean White. He says, hey, should you kill ryegrass or just cut it low when it's time for the Bermuda to wake up? You should kill it. You should spray it out. That's one of the reasons, in addition to me not like wanting to be out in cold weather, although this year it would have worked out because it hasn't been really that cold, with overseeding Bermuda with perennial rye, is that you have to, or no, you don't have to, but you should spray it. You should spray a selective herbicide, something like Celsius, on it when springtime rolls around, like when March rolls around, to get rid of it so that the Bermuda can grow through properly without having another grass type that it's competing with. There was a lawn in the neighborhood where they didn't do that. And like June-ish, June, July, it was still, actually I shouldn't say that, June, it was still looking really bad. It looked weird, like because the ryegrass was hating life because it was hot. And the Bermuda never really took off and really grew in well because you have this ryegrass that was also consuming a lot of the resources, right? So if you're going to go with ryegrass, if you're going to go with this whole overseeding thing, that's fine. But yes, you should absolutely plan to spray it out in March to get rid of it so that you are going to give the Bermuda the best possible chance to come out of dormancy well and to do well. So and to beat this to death a little bit more, Sean, this is another reason why I'm not a fan of doing rye, perennial rye, is that you're also spraying a selective herbicide. Granted, like something like Celsius is one of the milder selective herbicides and it is safe for Bermuda, but you're also spraying a herbicide on Bermuda when it's trying to come out of dormancy, which is really one of the worst times to spray a herbicide on your grass. I mean, yes, Celsius is safe for it. It's not going to kill it, assuming you follow the rate, but you're still adding a bit of stress to grass that's trying to come out of dormancy. So for those reasons, I'm not a huge fan of it, but if you've already put down perennial rye, plan on spraying it out in March to get the best out of your Bermuda. You absolutely want to get rid of it. I've seen what happens if you don't, and you trust me, you won't like it. It looks really, really, this looks crappy. It looks bad. It's the best way to describe it. It looks really bad because the ryegrass is really stringy and like hating life, and the Bermuda is like looking like dead oak, matted down carpet. Just doesn't look good. So yeah. All righty. All right. So Alex B is going back and forth with heartfelt. Very good. And then Crystal Gale has a comment saying, I have found some Espoma garden gypsum to work well at loosening my clay soil in my backyard garden, Georgia clay. I used two bags last year and it's fine. So there you go. You have someone that's actually used gypsum and it seemed like she had a good result in her lawn last year. So there you go. There's also the video from Soil Lab that I linked earlier, but there you have a question or a response from someone that's actually used gypsum on their clay soil in Georgia and they got a good result. So there you go. Mm-hmm. Appreciate that, Kayla. Kayla, it's Crystal. Thank you. Appreciate that, Crystal. Appreciate you chiming in. Thanks for the comment. All right. Yes, we got a bunch of people also chiming in saying that, yes, you definitely need to kill it out. And if you don't kill it, yeah, because it's going to, appearance-wise, it's going to look like absolute like Hades. You don't want to do that. You don't want to not spray it out if you decide to do that. All right. And you guys are, I'm glad that the comment or the question around choosing your mower carefully was well received. All right. This is a good question here from Brew Crew Fishing. Awesome name for a channel. Says, hey, is it a good time to do a soil test? Yes. I ordered a kit and wanted to know if now is a good time to conduct it or should I wait a few months? I'm in Central Texas. Thanks. Yes, you can do one now. I have been testing my... I need to get this one done. I haven't done one. I'm supposed to do one for New Year's Day and I didn't do one. I'm lagging, guys. But yes, you can do your soil test now, Brew Crew Fishing. What's going to happen is if it comes back and says, hey, Brew Crew, your lawn, your soil looks great, but you need like NPK. You need like nitrogen. It's deficient in nitrogen. You would not want to take that guidance. You won't want to follow that guidance now. You're going to wait until the grass is actively growing to follow that. But now let's say you're my next door neighbor. Like say you're here in Georgia and you check your soil test and your pH is a bit on the low side. So your soil is trending a bit acidic. So you're like mid fives or something, right? That's something you can start to address now. Like you can go out and you can go get some lime, whether a calcitic or a dolomitic lime, depending on like your magnesium levels. And you can begin to treat that and start taking care of that now. So there are benefits to getting a soil test done now. The data you get from it is still going to be valuable a couple of months from now when you're ready to start fertilizing your lawn and feeding it when the grass is actively growing. And if it's a case where your soil pH is on the low side, you can actually begin adjusting that now. So there's a tons of reason to do it, tons of value. There's no reason to wait several months is what I'm trying to say. Like, knowing now is going to allow you to formulate your plan of action for the spring. And if you are looking for a soil test, the one that I would recommend, shameless plug, is the one from the nice folks at MySoil. You can get these at the Golf Course Lawn Store. These are super easy to use. I think this one is this one. Yeah. So what you get with it is you get a prepaid envelope to mail said soil test kit in. You get a scoop for collecting, well, for like scooping the soil sample once you put them all together, once you mix it all together. And you get this container, which contains a synthetic root called ion exchange resin. That's like a ion exchange resin bulb and deionized water. So that's what you get in the soil test kit. It's super easy to use. If you want to make your life even easier, you can also at the store get one of these guys, which is a soil probe tool. MySoil makes these as well. We have these on the store. These make it really easy to collect your soil samples and then just put them in a bucket, mix them all up, make a big homogeneous mixture that represents your entire the soil for all your entire lawn. Take a couple of scoops, drop them in the container, mail it out, and within a week you're going to get results. It'll tell you what you need to do for your lawn, to improve the quality of the soil. So it's something to keep in mind. It's an option. And yes, to answer your question, you can do it tomorrow if you wanted to, if you had one. But if you don't have a soil test kit, golfcourselawn.store. All right, next up, we got Lance F. in the house. What's going on, Lance? He says, hey, Ron, happy Friday. Snow just melted in Reno, Nevada. That sounds horrible. Well, I mean, the snow melting sounds good, but snow just sounds horrible, but I'll continue. Anyway, Kentucky bluegrass is still looking green and great. Thank you, buddy. Or yeah, buddy. That's awesome. I'm glad that your KBG is looking good. Glad the snow is also melting. Snow is fun to look at, not fun to live in. So at least we're going the right way. And beasts like Blake, if you're in San Antonio, Texas, love San Antonio, really good food. If you're in San Antonio and I'm not sure what the temperatures are like there right now, but really, again, waiting until temps are a little bit on the warmer side is going to be better. So when I say warmer, above 55 degrees, above 60 degrees is best. You're gonna get a faster result using that certainty Celsius combo that I was telling you about. So hopefully that helps. You are very, very, very welcome. Thank you, Higgy Pop. I appreciate it. It says, hey, happy new year, Ron. Happy new year. Let's all hit the like button for Ron. I appreciate that, Higgy Pop. It's a great and free way to support the live, the channel. And a super chat from Lance. Lance, how dare I? I'm not sure if you did this already, but if not, I'll just do it again. Super chat received. I appreciate it. Thank you so much, Lance F. I'm not sure if I took care of your super chat, but if not, you got shout out twice. So thanks so much. I appreciate the love and support. And God, why do I even encourage you guys? You know, I make one comment about the kilt, and now this kilt thing's never gonna end. This is never gonna go away. It says kilt with any sprinklers is also a no-go and probably against YouTube guidelines. Please, Ron, no elbow cough. No, I'm not gonna, guys, it's gonna be a video. I mean, I don't even know that I'm gonna do maybe mowing. I could do a mowing patch with the kilt, but no sprinklers, probably no backpack sprayer, you know, just like probably a talking head video or talking like sitting out on the deck video is probably what we're going to do. It's not going to be anything too crazy. I'm not going to do anything that's going to cause you guys to get your eyes scarred. We're not going to do that. I'm going to be considerate, guys. Come on. We're going to be good to go. All right. Shelby Amos is a question about pre-emergent. It says, hey, sup, Ron, in Fort Worth, Texas, and I put down pre-emergent in early November. Okay. When should I put down another app before spring? So really the general guidance is before, keyword, before soil temps cross 55 degrees, not air temps, soil temps, before soil temps consistently cross 55 degrees. I am a fan of doing it a bit earlier than later. So if it were me, I would get your pre-emergent done late February, early March. I would not wait until like you've got like a string of weather where it's like 55 degrees because it's too late then. I mean, it's always better to be a bit early than to be late. You see what I mean? Because if you're late, then you're going to have some weeds that are going to start germinating and pre-emergent is not going to do anything against that. Or in most cases, they're not going to do much against it, right? Whereas if you're a bit early, still going to work and you're going to get better coverage and prevent, it's going to do what it's supposed to. It's going to prevent the weeds prior to them emerging. So late February, early March is what I would recommend as general guidance. But if you're trying to be super, super specific, before soil temps cross 55 degrees is what I would recommend. Last year we did Alex's lawn in late, the first week of January. Sorry, it's not first week. First week of February, late January, which is relatively early. And we had a great result on his lawn. So there you go. Next up, we have a question about blind sizes. Also, I have blind side. When should I blast weeds, spring green up, or a little bit before? Check the label for blind side. I'm not sure off the top of my head if there's any temperature restrictions on applying blind side, Shelby. If there's not, what you're going to find is if you spray with most of those types of herbicides, if you spray them a bit earlier in the season when temps are cooler, they tend to not work as quickly as if you waited until the springtime. So check the label, make sure there's no restrictions around the lower end of when you have to spray them. If you spray it when temps are cooler, just realize it's going to take a little bit longer normally in most cases for it to work. But yeah, there shouldn't be a problem with spraying it a bit before spring green up. Shouldn't be a problem with that at all. But again, check the label, see what the label says, and follow the label. Follow the label. All right. Andrew Phillips says, hey, Ron, back to moss for a minute. He says, can I use Headway G for moss and fungus on my lawn as well? I don't believe Headway is labeled for moss. There's a product from, I have to check the labels. It might be, but I've never known anyone to use it for moss. There's a product from Scott's called Moss EX or Moss X, whatever they call it. Like that works well. I don't even know. I'm not sure what the active ingredient in Moss X is to be able to tell you. It's not, I don't know. Let me see here. The active ingredient, does it say? I can't scroll in. So ferrous, some kind of sulfate, ferrous sulfate. So yeah, so it's different. It's different than what's in Headway G. So I'll send you a link here to that if you want for this. This is what, if you're trying to treat moss, I would use this. I would use a product designed to kill moss. If you're trying to treat lawn fungus, I would use Headway G at the rates that are correct for the type of fungus that you're trying to target. So it sounds like if you're dealing with fungus and moss, you're going to end up using two products. But again, you want to fix the drainage problem first. So let me put a link here in the chat for you. This is the chat or a link to Moss X, EX, and boom, there you go. And for Headway, if I can find it quickly. If you don't already have it, Andrew. If you already have Headway, I will give you a link for that as well. Of the two, you can do Heritage, but I would do Headway because you got two active ingredients. Better product. A little bit more money, better product. So if you're going to do it right. So though between those two, you should be able to knock out the moss and any fungus problems that you're dealing with in your lawn. So hopefully that helps. All right, JWork09 says, can I add Speed Zone with Certainty Image and Celsius WG? I wouldn't. Here's what I would do. I would not do that. So Speed Zone will work well, but it's gonna discolor your grass, kind of like Dismiss, right? Speed Zone is gonna smack the lawn a little bit harder. Can you mix it with if I were gonna do that? If you wanted to add something to Celsius and Certainty, again, I don't really think you need anything else. I really don't. I think Celsius and Certainty is a good combination all by themselves. Like adding a bit of Speed Zone with that, if you want to test it, I've not personally tested that concoction. It might be a bit much. If you want to add a little bit of Speed Zone at a light rate, like at a low rate, because again, you already got two selective herbicides in there. If you want to do that, then sure. I would not do Image with any of those because Image is designed to be watered in, is designed to, the way it works is different to the foliar post-emergent herbicide. So I would do, if you must have like a salad, like a post-emergent, combination, and you don't want to just do Certainty and Celsius, which again, I think is plenty. You really shouldn't need Speed Zone. Speed Zone is the only thing that I would add. That's the only thing that I would add with Certainty and Celsius. But again, I would go very light on the rate because you already got two potent herbicides that work really well. I don't know if you add Speed Zone to that, what you're probably gonna get some discolor. Here's the reason why I'm actually gonna say just don't do it because like the reason why I chose Certainty and Celsius is because you can spray them when temperatures are high. There's not really a lot of temp restrictions around those two products. and they're mild from a standpoint of damaging the grass. As far as like damaging your Bermuda, discoloring it, CertainTeed and Celsius are very, very good about not doing that while being very effective at killing the weeds. If you add Speed Zone to the mix, like you're getting rid of like the big reason to even do use like CertainTeed, right? Like the secret sauce of CertainTeed is that you can spray it when it's super hot outside. It kills, CertainTeed and Celsius is that you can spray them when it's really hot outside. It kills the stuff that you want to kill, doesn't damage your grass. As soon as you start introducing Speed Zone, now you got to be really careful of the temps you spray it at. It's still going to discolor the grass and you're just getting rid of some of the advantages. So for me, I would do Celsius and CertainTeed. Or if you're going to do Speed Zone and something like Dismiss. Like if you don't care if the grass gets discolored and you want something that's going to work really fast, like Speed Zone Dismiss combo works really well, but it's going to discolor the grass. And then Image, I would do, you know, without any of those. So that be my thoughts on the matter, J-Work. Hopefully that helps. All right. Lavendi says, question. I know it's off topic. What camera would you recommend for Zoom meetings, excluding webcams? Okay. So if you, it depends, man. If you want a good webcam to where you're the guy in the meetings, guy or gal in the meetings, where people are saying, man, your camera looks really, really good, Lavendi. What's you doing for your video? Looks like you're sitting right here. Then you're going to want to use a good mirrorless camera. Here's the thing. It's a very expensive solution to this problem, because really, if you're gonna do something like that, I would go with something like an A7S III, like a Sony A7S III. It's like a $3,000 camera. It's a very expensive solution to the problem. But here's why. One, there are no recording limits in it. It doesn't overheat, meaning you could like literally turn, like when I was doing my live streams, like if you guys looked at my video, my live streams from around this time last year, the video that you were looking at was a Sony A7S III. It's the camera that's on that gimbal right now, right? So, and it never overheats. So meaning you can turn it on and you can leave it running all day for hours and hours on end. And you're never going to have problems with it. Even though it's a mirrorless camera, it's a video centric mirrorless camera. So there's lots of other cameras that you can use. Like even the A1 is a great camera, but you gotta be kind of careful with it. If you turn on 8K mode, it'll overheat on you. The A7S III will not do that. And it doesn't have, like as far as streaming 4K, there's not gonna be any problems with it. I mean, it's like one of those things, buy once, cry once. There are cheaper cameras, like Canon makes some good cameras as well. You can do like the Sony, like the ZV-1, some people like those, but then those overheat, the battery life is terrible. You can't plug it in and where it will run off of power reliably, without overheating, whereas the Sony, again, A7S III, you can get like a dummy battery, stick it in there, and it will literally run for days, days and days on end, no problem. But it's more expensive because you got to buy the camera and then you got to buy a lens for it. So, you know, by the time you're all in, you're spending several thousand dollars, which is just a very expensive solution to that problem. But it's going to look like this. It's going to look maybe not like this camera, because this camera is like a next step above the A7S III. But it will look like this. This is what it will look like. Your video is going to look like how this looks. So if this looks good to you, get a mirrorless camera. So it's an expensive way to go, but you can also use it for video. You can use it for pictures. You can do it for a lot of cool stuff with it. But yeah, that's what I would recommend. The cheaper cameras are going to end up being more headache than they're worth. And then you're going to want to also get, actually, no, you don't even need a capture card anymore, because the new Sony drivers will work natively. Like it'll present itself as a camera to your operating system. So you don't even need like a capture card anymore if you don't want to do that. Very good. All right, cool. Hopefully that helps, Lavendi. If not, you have more questions, send me an email, ron@golfcourselawn.com. I'll send you right there. Just send me an email. I love talking about camera gear and stuff, so send me an email and I'll help you out any way I can. But hopefully that gets you on the right track. And it will look way better than a webcam. Webcams don't look that great. All right, next up we have Tom V. He says, hey, Ron, haven't been on in a while. Well, that's you and most people, because you figure it's been like winter and people don't really care about their grass as much during the winter months, but you're back, so that's good. So your question is there any difference you'd recommend when applying PGR to longer grass, 2.5 inches to 3 inches, versus lower cut turf? Wondering what app rate to use. I wouldn't change the application rate based on the height of cut. I really wouldn't. So for Bermuda, if you have Bermuda on, really the safe rate is 0.25 ounces, so a quarter of an ounce. A quarter of an ounce mixed with 1 gallon of water, and you're going to spray that over 1,000 square feet. So what that means is if you have a 4 gallon backpack sprayer, you are going to mix up 1 ounce, like so 0.25 times 4. You're going to mix up 1 ounce of PGR, which is, if you're looking here at this cup, measuring cup, it's right there. Like, this is 4 ounces. So literally, it's right there. That first notch is 1 ounce, and that's enough to cover 4,000 square feet. And here's the thing, Tom, if this is your first time doing PGR, I beg and implore you to please do not go heavy. Like, literally follow that rate. You don't need to go heavier than that. Now, once you've done like your first time, you get a good result. Okay, I know what I'm doing. I've got my walking pace down. The sprayer's calibrated. I'm not going to nuke my lawn. If you have one of the Tifways, like you have like Tifway 419 or like a hybrid Bermuda, you can go up to a rate of 0.38 ounces. So right at 1.6 fluid ounces for 4,000 square feet. So you can go a little bit heavier over if you have one of the hybrids for common Bermuda or a rate that's just going to be safe. A quarter of an ounce per 1,000 square feet. Again, for hybrid, you can go a bit heavier. But that's for after you've done an application. You know you've got your walking pace down and everything is good. You checked the grass. You didn't go too heavy and that kind of thing. So yes. But to answer your question, no, I would not increase the rate. I would not go heavier with longer grass because really you're going to be using a T-jet tip or some kind of a foliar spray tip. And all longer grass means is more leaf to cover, right? So you don't really necessarily need to go heavier. Like, just the mere fact that you have longer grass, each blade of grass is going to take up more of the product. You're really covering more of it, right? So no, I wouldn't change the rate. Stick to that low rate. Start at that low rate of 0.25 ounces with 1 gallon of water per 1,000 square feet, which equates to 1 ounce for 4,000 square feet when mixed with 4 gallons of water. So I've got a video on PGR. Just go look up YouTube, Ron Henry PGR. I've got tons of videos on PGR. Just look for my one from like last year where I go through this entire thing again. And there's going to be a video that's going to be coming out soon on PGR where if you are looking for PGR in a smaller quantity, the nice folks at Syngenta have now made Primo Max available in a 4 ounce container. So before you had to go buy a gallon of this stuff and it was crazy expensive, and now you can buy it at a much more reasonable price. And you can, you're using like the Syngenta product, right? So if you care about name brand and you want to use Trinexapac ethyl, then Primo Max, that's the way to go. And you can now get this in a smaller quantity, which is something that a lot of people are a fan of. And I think I have a link for that. I think I do. Let me make sure it works here before I send it to you. And you'd be like, oh my God, you sent me a link in 404 error. What's going on? What kind of tech guy are you? Let's see. Yep, I do. Cool. So here you go. So I'll put a link right here in the chat. If you don't have your PGR as yet, Tom B, you can get yourself a nice small 4 ounce container, which for most people, assuming that you have a 4,000 or 5,000 square foot lawn, in most cases you're going to get, this is enough for a season. So you figure most people start doing PGR late April, early May. So you do April, May, June, July. So for most folks, one of these is enough to take you for the entire season. So hopefully that helps. Let me know if I can help with anything else. And the big thing with PGR is do not go heavy. Trust me, you do not need to go heavy to get a great result. 0.25 ounces is all you need for Bermuda. And for cool season grass, the rate is heavier, I think. I think it goes up to like around 0.5 ounce per 1,000. But again, just check the label. The label tells you exactly how much to use. All right. Thin Cut says, you are correct, sir. You got like everything there. Sheep, goats, chicken. Like I said in the last live stream, with your advice, I dominate the street. Awesome. Love to hear it. Love to hear that. All right, and then Roderick Rice says, "Where do you recommend Coastal at the best value per ounce?" Well, Do My Own has really good price on it when it was in stock. I don't know if it's in stock now. I have a contact there. I'll reach out to them and ask them about it, if and when they're going to get it back in stock. If you can find it local, I mean, here's the thing. I want to say that Coastal is set. There's like map pricing on it, so I don't think you can really. There's not going to be a huge price swing with Coastal. I think there's a minimum price that they specify what you need to sell it for. So it's going to be like $95 or something for the small one, which for most people is plenty, and a lot more for the big one. But yeah, I think that's pretty much the standard across the board. So hopefully that helps. But I'll take a look. All right, Lanceup says, the hater dude sounds like the dude from Office Space. That's what the haters sound like, man. They sound like the Office Space dude, right? They hate because they ain't, right? So, yeah. All right, Shelby Amos has a question. Near and dear to my heart says, thoughts on TrueCut new ownership. All right, okay, all right. So new TrueCuts. We're stepping into getting a new one. All right. Real Rollers email says they will up the quality. But they are going to focus on a commercial line like you. I need the tires for my slope. So here's the thing. My TrueCut is brand new, and I bought it brand new. And it's been flawless. It's been a great, great mower. That said, you can buy a pre-owned one and save yourself like $1,000. You know, even if you got like a premium pre-owned TrueCut. So let's say you're spending like $1,250. With that, you're gonna get the roller. You're gonna get a low miles or low hours mower, and you can save yourself like $1,000. Going brand new though is, if you can swing it, that's the way to go, because you know you got a fresh mower, no one else's problems. It's in great shape. It's gonna serve you for a really long time. You know, it's just you realize you're paying a premium for that newness, right? And it's not, especially with TrueCuts, they're such well-built mowers that you're not really giving up a whole lot by buying a pre-owned one. I haven't seen the new ones here lately to know if they've changed them, if they've made some changes to the mowers so they've improved the quality of them. I mean, mine is really good quality. But yeah, that might be something. If they've upped the quality or changed some little things or made some adjustments, that's what you're going to get in the new one, whereas you're not going to get that in a pre-owned one. So that's one thing to consider. If you get one, get the commercial. Get the C25 or C27 or C20, depending on which way, size of the lawn that you have. So something to keep in mind. All right. Great question. And yeah, if you get one, get one from Real Rollers. Get one from Real Rollers or check out who else does them in this area. Also check out Pat. Keystone in Duluth. They also sell them as well. So Real Rollers or Keystone, any of those guys. But check out, support Lee and those guys. Like, that's what they do. They also stock a full assortment of parts, and they're a really good set of guys. So, give Real Rollers some support and love. Yes. And then Real Roller Alert, looking for at a TrueCut C25 or C27. Very nice. Very, 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 very cool. All right. So we got another question here from Josh. From Josh Bronco says, I laid 20,000 square feet of Tif Tough last August. Wow. Congratulations, man. That's a lot of work. Says, do you think I can do pre-emergent? Let me see. Last August. Do you think I can do pre-emergent this early spring, or will that cause root issues? The turf has been holding back the majority of weeds, but I've been hand-picking weeds. Okay. So, general guidance will say that if you do like new lawns, that you want to give the lawn a year before spraying pre-emergent. I will tell you that my lawn was sodded in December, and it got pre-emergent in March when this place was built. So like 3 months, and there were no issues with it. You did your pre-emergent in August. So really, if you waited till February, we're looking at like 6 months thereabouts. So yeah, you're gonna be good to go. I mean, if it were my lawn, I would put pre-emergent down this spring. Absolutely. You can wait till next fall if you want, but Bermuda's should be already well established by then. Bermuda is not like some of the cool season lawn or turf types where you really want to give them a year before you do any kind of pre-emergent. You're good to go, Josh. If it were me, I can tell you what the general boilerplate answer is: wait a year. I can tell you what I did, which was like 3 months. And in your case, you being August, September, October, November, December, January, February, March, it's like 8 months. Absolutely. Get your pre-emergent down, man. I would do that. No way I would not do pre-emergent if I were you, given what you just explained to me. Good stuff. All right. Shelby has a point here about overseeding with rye, saying, I overseed with rye. I didn't spray it out. And while keeping up with the carbon kit, it looked awesome. Never looked too bad. Okay. And in the summer, it looked great where Bermuda was in the shade. Kept it at 3/4 inch. All right. So I don't know, Shelby, maybe you're the exception, man. But in most cases, people that put down perennial ryegrass or overseed with perennial ryegrass and don't get rid of it, especially in a lawn that sees full sun. So in your case, it sounds like you had like some shaded areas. But if you have a lawn that gets full sunlight, Like I've seen that, and it does not look good. It does not like it. It's not pretty. It's not pretty if you have Bermuda and rye mixed around when once like May, June timeframe rolls around. And the Bermuda just takes a longer time to come out of dormancy. But if your lawn is, it sounds like you're dealing with some shade, in that case, maybe it will work well. But in general, you want to get rid of the ryegrass. In general, you want to get rid of the ryegrass in the areas that you want the Bermuda to be dominant. So it sounds like you did this and it worked well for you. For most people, they're going to be better served by getting rid of it. But thanks. I appreciate the feedback. Appreciate you letting me know. And it sounds like you kept it at 0.75 inches. That's a good point as well. So that's a good point. The person that overseeded their lawn was cutting it with a rotary mower. So they're already doing it wrong for the Bermuda. They were cutting it way too high. Maybe at lower heights of cut, maybe it will do better. Maybe at 3/4 of an inch, maybe you can get away with it, right? But even then, the Bermuda will do well if it's not competing with another grass type. So just something to consider. Great, great feedback. I appreciate you. All right, Masama Blues in the house. What's going on, sir? Thanks for coming to hang out. It says, Happy New Year, Ron and gang. Happy New Year to you. Hopefully you're doing well, staying healthy. All right, next up, we got Frank V in the house. He says, Hey, Ron, I got my hat in the mail. Thank you. You're very, very welcome, sir. Thanks. I'm glad that it made it safe. You can never know these days with the Postal Service. He says, My yard is greening up early. I guess this year, is it too early to fertilize? Yes, don't fertilize yet. I can like definitively say that. Don't fertilize your lawn yet. I'm mowing every 2 weeks here. Well, I may have to take it back. I'm mowing every 2 weeks here in North Florida. Thanks. Okay, when you say you're mowing, is the grass actively growing? I mean, even in North Florida, is it do you have to mow every 2 weeks, or are you just doing it because you have an itch and you're scratching it? I would still say, Frank, mowing every 2 weeks is better than, obviously, it's a greater mowing frequency than what we're seeing here in Georgia. But I would still wait until like late February, early March before I put fertilizer down. I just really would, man. You want the grass to be actively growing before you put fertilizer down on the lawn. You just really do. There's people that don't fertilize their lawn until like April, you know? I know that this year we've had a warmer winter weather. So that's something to keep in mind. But if it were me, I would still give it a bit more time. Late February, let's say we have this warming trend and it sticks around. Late February at the earliest, really into March is when you want to be doing that. It's not going to hurt anything to wait a little bit longer. You know what I mean? So I would give it a bit more time. Glad that your lawn's looking good though. Cool stuff. All right, Mr. Josh Habib, you're starting trouble. He says, Roll Tide, Ron, big week for your dogs. I think they get it done. We'll see, man. We'll see. I would like to see them win. They should. I mean, they saw Alabama. It's like you got the answers to the tests in the divisional championship, right? You got the answer to the test. You saw what Saban and the Crimson are going to do. No reason to not win this time around, but it is Georgia. You know, my only concern, Josh, not to go off on a tangent here, but it's getting late, so we can go off on a tangent a little bit, is that Georgia stops playing. Like, we'll start playing. We'll start, like, just killing it the first half. And for some reason, we come out of the locker room and forget there's still a football game going on, and they start just doing dumb things, right? You even saw it with the game against Michigan. Now, granted, yes, we were beating them really handily, but they just sort of started doing dumb stuff. Like, they had, like, the one defensive guy that had, like, 40 yards in penalties. Like, you just can't do that. I mean, that will work against Michigan. You can't do that against Alabama. Like, they're going to make us pay for it. So playing football all four quarters, like keeping the hammer down the entire time is what they're going to have to do to beat Alabama. If they don't, it's going to be like the Falcons and the Patriots in the Super Bowl. We're going to take off with a great lead, and then Alabama is going to just, Saban and the Crimson are going to come back third and fourth quarter, and they're going to beat us. So they got to, Kirby, I'm sure you're not watching this, but if any of the Alabama, if any of the Georgia players are watching this, or anyone associated with the University of Georgia is playing and watching this, please play football all four quarters up until the last second of the fourth quarter. Like, keep your foot on their throat if you guys are winning. Do not back down. That's the only way we win. All right, tirade done. Can you tell a little bit passionate about this, Josh? Can you tell? Mainly because I'm tired of all you guys coming in here all the time with all this Roll Tide and, Georgia sucks and all this kind of stuff. I want us to win, so we'll see if we get it done. We'll see. Jose's like, Bama gonna whoop that butt again. You're probably right, but Georgia should win. We are the better team. If they just play football all four quarters, we should win. But We'll know. We're going to know in less than a week. We're going to know in 3 days. We'll see. All right. You're very, very welcome, Brew Crew Fishing. I appreciate the support. Thank you so much. Let me know if you have any questions once you get your soil test done with interpreting the results. Send me an email. I don't have it up right now, but I will here in a second. Ron@golfcourselawn.com. You can send me an email with the results, and I'll say, hey, listen, this is what I think you should be applying. The results are actually pretty easy to interpret and understand on your own. You really don't need my help to do it. It's one of the big reasons why I really like promoting these kits. One, because they are very good, very fast, very accurate, and they're easy. So someone that's just thinking, you know, I want to get into soil testing. I want to, like, you know, do the best I can for the soil on my lawn. These are easier than some of the tests that you would get from the extension offices. Some people want to say this, the extension office tests are cheaper, but if you test for nitrogen, if you test for everything that my soil tests for, it's six, half a dozen. It's comparable. And the results are way easier to interpret from my soil than they are from one of the extension offices. Not saying anything wrong with that, but they're just for a person that doesn't understand the different nutrients and what they mean and the interactions and that type of stuff. It's just way easier. Like, literally with the soil, your nutrient levels, it literally say, hey, for your soil, like, buy this and apply this. Like, it literally tells you what to do. I like easy. So there you go. All right. Frank Mazama Blue, Frank V says, and all the hat winners, if you put the hat on the grass, it helps it green up like magic, especially if it's Ron Henry hat. All right. I'll take that, Mazama. I'd like to think that's true. So, and if you take a picture of it, of the hat on the lawn, and you send it to me, I'll post it in the live stream. So if you guys want to show off your lawn and show off the swag you got, by all means. I think Plus Mirror Mutual Green would like to see that. So if any of you guys that won hats, if you want to take a picture of them, either you wearing them or put them on the lawn, if you don't want, you know, people to know what you look like, by all means do that. And I will post it, you know. And again, to also you guys as well, remember, it's an open invitation. If you guys have your lawns and you want to show off your lawn on the show, I'm more than willing to show off, you know, any lawns that you guys want to send me pictures and I'll show them. Just let me know that, hey, yeah, this is for the live streams. Put that in the subject line, like pics for the live stream or something like that. And then I'll show them off, especially as we get closer on, you guys start dominating like crazy. You know, send me pictures and we'll show everybody like how your lawns are performing this growing season. I think this growing season is going to be pretty awesome, man. I think it's going to be good. Confidence is high. All right, NASCAR for Life has a question. It says, okay, we're talking about pre-emergence. So I live in the South Florida and temps are never below 70 degrees. LOL. But serious, the temps never get low here. So do I still follow the same rules for pre-emergent? You know, if you look at Alan, he's a fan of like pre-emergent year-round. So I'll give you the answer, and I'll say it depends, NASCAR for Life. So if you're using, because it depends on the pre-emergence you're using. If you're using prodiamine or dithiopyr, two apps per year is really going to be enough, more than likely. If you want to go a little bit lighter on your rate and do three apps, that's not going to hurt anything. If you are using like a premium pre-emergent, like Spectacle Flow, like one of I always can't forget the active ingredient. It's something flam, indazaflam or imdazaflam, I forget, something like that. It starts with an I. If using Spectacle Flow, really you can still just do it twice a year, because Spectacle Flow, if you look at their label, one app done well, they say will give you coverage up to 10 months. It's a really, really good pre-emergent. It's super expensive, so it ought to be good. So it really depends. If you're using prodiamine or dithiopyr, again, twice per year is really still should be enough. If you want to do a third app, by all means, go for it. If you're using something like, again, like using like prodiamine as one of like, as like your cheaper option, one of your, like for one application, and then Spectacle Flow as like the, for your other app, then really you're only going to be doing two, because that's a very, very good pre-emergent. And it has like a much longer coverage than prodiamine or dithiopyr at the heavier rates. Those guys are really four or five months. I mean, there's factors, but you tend to get a good 4 or 5 months out of those. Whereas again, with Spectacle Flow, apply at the right rate and good conditions, can be up to 10 months. So just depends on what you're doing. So hopefully that helps. But in your case, the rule of at least twice a year applies. So yes. At least twice a year. All right. You're very, very welcome, Andrew. And next up, we have a question here from Kevin Smith. He says, which would you prefer, organic fertilizer or synthetic fertilizer for centipede grass? Either one can work well. I used to do only organics on my lawn. I used to do a big fan of Milo until it got too expensive. The big thing with a lot of organics, is that the cost per application tends to be a bit more expensive than synthetics, right? If you could get an organic that had that fed the lawn, so it had like a, you know, a lighter, it had a good formulation, a good NPK formulation that based on what your soil needs, and it also had like some biochar in it maybe, or some, you know, had some other additives, then that makes a really compelling argument in my mind for the extra cost per app that is often associated with organic fertilizer. The thing with synthetic, something like Humic Max, like this guy here, the stuff that I recommend from Lebanon Turf, this is really good stuff, is that it just goes further. Like you can get like humic acid. Like good example, the reason why I love this stuff so much is because one bag treats up to like 15,000 square feet, so you get a lot more coverage out of it. It works, it'll work just fine on your centipede grass, so no problems at all there. And you also get like almost 9% humic acid, so 8.9% humic acid built into the product. So you're feeding the soil and your grass at the same time. You know, if there's organics, like if an organic came out that was, again, had NPK, and also had like humic acid or biochar, then yeah, then it's kind of really your preference, right? It's the thing you will find is that with the organics, you tend to have lower percentages of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. So depending on what the soil needs, you might have to go at a much heavier rate with organics, or it may not be like economically feasible to do major corrections using an organic fertilizer. That's where the synthetics come in, because you can get anything all the way up to straight urea, right? So as far as being able to go with much higher concentrations of nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus, synthetics are really good for that. But as far as like as a regular feeding program, especially if everything's all good in your lawn, you're just looking for, if you had a really good organic, again, that also had some of those other components, some of those biostimulants to help improve soil quality, I'd be all for it. I think they're a great option. So the long short is they are both good. If you are using a quality product, you tend to pay more for app for organics than you do for synthetics. That's just the name of the game. So hopefully that helps, Kevin. Either one will work well for you. Either one will get you a good result. All right, Luke Colts says, I want my lawn like Super Bowl grass. You can do that. So if you want like a golf course lawn, you came to the right place. If you want a lawn that looks like this, I mean, granted, my lawn is right now is dormant, so it's not green. But if you want a lawn that looks like that, literally, that's what we teach people how to do in the Golf Course Lawn Academy at golfcourselawn.com, and also in the various videos, the free content. Like we also talk about that on the live stream, same type of thing. But yeah, if you're looking for like a targeted approach, golfcourselawn.com, that's the course that I put together that will take you from zero to hero as far as your lawn goes in the shortest time possible. So you got to take your lawn from normal to pretty awesome in the course of like a 3-month period thereabouts. But a lot of it's just, I will give you the answers to the test. It comes down a lot of it to mowing. Like you have to soil test, you got to fertilize accordingly. But the most important thing is you gotta mow. You have to regularly commit to mowing your lawn at least twice a week. That's the secret sauce to having, you know, great looking turf. And then when you start adding on, you know, your biostimulants, you start adding like the carbon kit, carbon pro G, essential G, then it becomes like super awesome. Then you get the fake looking grass look, right? But the staple, the foundation, is a soil test, get a qual and feed the soil based on the soil test results. So use a quality fertilizer and then just mow at least twice a week. That's what it's going to take to get an awesome looking lawn. So hopefully that helps. Stick around, man. Come stick around on the live stream. Check out my channel for other content. Check out the course if you're interested in that. And I've got tons of different content that will help you get exactly what you're looking for, assuming you're willing to mow your lawn twice a week and buy a real mower. Because that's another thing too. You got to have the right mower for your grass type to make the grass look the way you want it to look. All right. Andrew Phillips says, when I purchase your Golfers Lawn program, will that give me the channel membership or is that a separate fee? It's separate, man. There's no way for me to do that. The Golf Course Lawn Academy is like my product. That's separate. That's something that I put together. Whereas like the channel membership, which again starts at like $5 a month, not super expensive, like less than the cost of like a Happy Meal or like, you know, whatever, like a number 3 at Chick-fil-A. for like less than $5 a month, you can do the channel membership. But because that's done by YouTube, I can't, there's literally no way to have them connect, unfortunately. One thing you do get with the Golf Course Lawn Academy is you get access to the private Facebook group, which is where you have like a bunch of other like-minded people, other people that are also committed to like to improving their lawns. We have a good time in there. It's a great way to get a lot more targeted help. Like as things have been growing on the channel, I pay attention to what's happening in the Facebook group, like first and foremost. The Facebook group is first, and then people that are channel members, if they send me an email, they're next priority, and then comments and other emails that I get. So like anything else, the people that are paying me get faster response time than people that aren't. I still respond to everybody as best as I can. Like I'm gonna ignore you, but just people that are supporting the channel, I have to give them the priority. So hopefully that helps, Andrew. And whichever way you decide to support the channel, I appreciate it. Thanks so much. All righty. Next up, we said here, Shelby says they just got bought by another company, Midwest Machines. I think that's what I was talking about. I'm not sure what you're talking about, Shelby, but okay. All right. Next up, we have Music in the House. Says, hey, from Brisbane, Australia. Hey, what's going on, man? That's pretty awesome from down under. Says, I have a Queensland blue cooch. It isn't really a Bermuda variety. It's just called that. Just called cooch. It only has stolons. So only stolons, no rhizomes. Okay, cool. I think, who does it I see? Is it, I think it's Lawn Tips. I forget his first name. But Lawn Tips also talks about when his last lawn, he had a section that was cooch. A cooch lawn. But cool. Thank you for coming to chime in in the live stream from down under. Appreciate you, man. Thanks for the support. Always cool to have viewers from overseas. Thanks, and thanks so much. I really, really, really do appreciate it. Jinwan, what's going on, man? Happy New Year. He says, what's going on, sir? He says, my Bermuda is at 0.3 inches. You're not messing around, man. Wow. 0.3 inches. It's still green in Austin, Texas. We've only had a couple days below freezing temps, and I can still see the tips that are turning light brown. With warmer temps this year, it may never go dormant. You're right, dude, especially with a 0.3 inch height of cut. Dude, you're getting plenty of sunlight, any little bit of heat is getting down to the grass. I'm not surprised you're still green. I'm not surprised that you're still green at all. And you're right. If we don't get a long cold snap, it's very likely that your lawn will never go fully dormant. You'll have like parts of your lawn that are like how my front lawn looks. I mean, you're probably greener than that if you're at 0.3 inches. But yeah, given that low height of cut and warmer temps, I'm not surprised that your lawn is still green this time of year. Very cool. Cool stuff, man. Thanks for chiming in. Happy New Year, and I hope that you are doing well. Here's to a great 2022 season, right? All right, Travis is in the house. Travis Winston says, hey, late to the show. Happy New Year to you, Ron. Happy New Year, Travis, and the rest of the Golf Course Lawn Squad. The lawn is looking tight, Travis. It's looking green, man. I'm not sure where that picture's from, but it looks really good. I appreciate you chiming in. Naomi's in the house. What's going on, Naomi? Says, awesome. Thank you for coming to hang out in the live stream for a little bit. I appreciate you. Thanks for all the love and support. Hope you're doing well and behaving. All right. And then next up, we have Kevin D. Jones says, in the name of Ricky Bobby, don't you put that evil on Georgia. Take it back, please. Listen, dude, listen. I am not putting evil. But Kevin, listen, here's the thing. The first step of making progress is acceptance or whatever it is. But one of the phases you got to recognize there's a problem. Our problem is we don't play all four quarters. And it's better we have this talk, we have to come to Jesus now than on Tuesday morning, because it's too late then, right? We need to have this talk now. We need to talk it out now, all come together and realize that Georgia has got to play hard football all four quarters. All four quarters. We've already demonstrated that, you know, we are the best two teams in the country right now by far. Like Big Ten got curb stomped. We dominated them. But for us to beat Bama, they got to play all four quarters. If we play all four quarters, we win. I'll put you there. How about that? I'm a Georgia fan. I support Georgia. If Georgia plays hard all four quarters and doesn't do dumb stuff like in like the third and fourth quarter, like they are prone to do, we're going to win the game. If they don't do that, we're probably going to lose. So there you go. There you go. Hopefully, that's my prediction. We'll see. We'll see. If they play all four quarters, we win. So let's see what happens next week and during the next live stream, right? All right. Your nightmare. Ooh, it's kind of scary and ominous. Says, I live in the middle of New Mexico. We are in the 40s and 50s right now, how we are in Georgia. Says, is there any benefit to the lawn to mow a few times throughout the winter? Yeah, man. Of course there's benefits. I mean, if you it looks good, makes the lawn look nice. if you are someone that wants to change the height of cut, I mean, we're still a bit early for scalping, but if you want to change the height of cut and you want to slowly bring that down a little bit over the course of, you know, this time to where when springtime rolls around, you already got the lawn, the height that you want to maintain it at, that's another reason to do it. But yeah, I mean, just from an apparent standpoint alone, it's I'm a fan of doing that. So, you know, you don't have to mow it anywhere near the same frequency that you do when the lawn is actively growing, obviously. But I mean, if you, once every few weeks, every 3 weeks, you want to get out there and just knock the dust off the mower, off the lawn, by all means, do that. Again, what you're seeing here in the back lawn, that is me double cutting the lawn today. I didn't take very much off of it. And it looks nice. It just looks cool, right? It's stripes. It looks cool. So that's a big reason to do it. So you don't have to, but it looks nice. That is the reason to go that route. And Nightmare says, what type of mower should I get for Bermuda? Okay, so this is here's the thing. the best mower for Bermuda, Zoysia, and shortcut turf in general is a real mower. I go into saying that with realizing that you have to be someone is good that's fine with mowing your lawn twice a week. If you're not someone that, if you don't like mowing your grass, or you're not at least open to mowing your grass twice, because here's the thing that's going to happen in your nightmare, especially if you're new to this. When you first hear, you got to mow your grass at least twice a week, you're like, that sounds crazy. It's absolute nonsense. There's no way I'm going to ever do that. However, I promise you, I can almost guarantee, and I don't give out guarantees very often, but I can almost guarantee that if you start mowing your grass twice a week, once you start seeing the results, you're going to fall in love with doing it. And you'll be out there 3 times a week mowing it, because the more often you mow your lawn, the better it's going to look. As far as the mower types, like a True Cut makes a really good one. Toro makes a really good one. Their Greensmaster line of mowers are all excellent mowers. A real mower cuts the grass like a pair of scissors versus like a rotary mower, which cuts it like hitting it with like a machete. You can still get a good cut, a decent cut with a rotary mower, but a real mower is the correct type of mower to use on Bermuda if you have the time and desire to real mow. If you don't have the time and desire to real mow, in other words, if you're gonna mow these people that's gonna cut your grass once every 2 weeks, don't buy a real mower. You're gonna hate it. It's because the grass is not gonna look good. And real mowers are designed for shortcut turf, and by that I mean inch and a half and lower, really an inch and lower, and which requires mowing at least twice a week. If you can do that, you're gonna get a great looking lawn. You're gonna have a lawn that looks just like this. You can have a front lawn that looks like that. It's gonna look like a golf course. So that's the thing I'd say. And so as far as which real mower to get, there's tons of different brands. There's, you know, whatever. There's True Cut, Toro, Alette, Swordman, California Shred. There's all kinds of brands. What I would recommend is in your area, fine. Like if you're in the Georgia area, if you're in Northeast Georgia, good. Congrats, because there's tons of places to get your mower worked on. But I'm a big fan of True Cut mowers because they are built like tanks. The parts for them are reasonably priced. There's tons of places that can service them, and just with very basic maintenance, they just do really, really well. They're a low hassle type mower. If you are wanting the absolute best quality of cut, like if your thing is, you know what, I don't necessarily care if I have to deal with a bit of inconvenience, but I want the best possible cut I can get on my lawn, then you're going to want a greens mower. So really in that space, you've got two options. In pre-owned mowers, you've got Toro or you've got John Deere. I'm a Toro guy. I like Toro. Most people like Toros, the Toro Greensmasters. That's what you're going to want to go with. A True Cut is going to give you an awesome quality of cut. Like a good example, this is a lawn cut with a green. Here's a lawn that's cut with a Greensmaster. I'm going to show you Daryl's lawn. I think I've got a picture here of it somewhere. Maybe. Let's see. Do I have it? Let's see if it'll load up. Yeah. So that's lawn is an example of a lawn that's cut with a True Cut, which looks pretty awesome, right? Looks awesome. Like you would never hate that, right? It looks awesome. But that same lawn, if that lawn were cut with a greens mower, it would look even better. It would look even better. Believe it or not. If you look at that, and you say that looks incredible. When you put a greens mower on it, it's gonna look fake. It's gonna look literally it's gonna look awesome. It's another level above a True Cut, but there's a lot more hassle associated with them. Parts are more expensive. You have to kind of ask yourself whether it's worth it. You're getting into diminishing returns when you go into a greens mower, whereas like the True Cut is like the sweet spot. Like you get like most of the benefit with the least amount of hassle. So something to keep in mind. Hopefully that helps answer your question. Sorry for the long-winded answer. I like real mowers, so you got me talking about them, so I spoke about them. All right, so next up we have Josh. He says, with you coming up to 3/4 inch this year, which I'm already at, like what you're seeing right here, Josh, like this right here, that's 3/4 inch you're looking at right there. That's already 3/4 inch. He says, when will you scalp? What height will you cut at? And will you catch the clippings since you're already letting them drop? So I will still scalp. I'll take it down a little bit, like maybe like 0.628, like like 5/8. I'll take it down below half an inch, just a touch, just a taste. I will do that. It'll probably be February when I do it, mainly because when March rolls around, all I have to do is mow. I don't have to worry about like scalping, because I hate scalping. It's actually, I like doing it, but I hate doing it because it does help the lawn green up faster, but it's such a mess and a hassle that I just want to get it done when there's nothing else to do, if that makes sense. And you said, will you catch the clippings? Yes, I will catch the clippings whenever I bring the height of cut down. Whenever I scalp it, I will use the grass catchers and catch the clippings. So hopefully that helps. Good question. And then as far as scalp height, I think I already answered that, but 0.62, 0.65, somewhere in there, just a little bit below 3/4 inch, 0.75 is what I'll end up doing. I'll use the True Cut for that. And then once I'm done with the True Cut, then I'll switch to the greens mower and I'll just mow with that all season. So hopefully that helps. All right, R. Reed is in the house. He says, hey, Ron, finally made one of your live chats. I appreciate the advice and the knowledge, man. You're very, very welcome. Thank you for coming in. Thanks for being taking some time out of your Friday evening to come talk about lawn care. It's always fun and cool. I think it's cool. So I appreciate the support and you just being a viewer. And then we got, let's see what we got here. We got George. What's going on, Princess Cut? George is in the house. If you guys that don't know about George, he is also another YouTuber, has a YouTube channel. So check out his content, especially if you have cool season lawn, a cool season turf, and you want to learn about, you know, some options for getting the most out of it. Check out his content. Him, Justin, they, you know, those guys put out a lot of really good content. So check them out. Thanks for coming to hang out in the live stream, George. Hopefully you are doing well. Hope you're doing well. Looks like you got some fans in the house here of your content as well. All right, next up, we got, as we're closing out here, last couple of comments before we sign off for the evening. Windchair is like, I have no dog in the fight. Uh-huh. So I see what you did there. I see what you did there. He says, I am an ND fan. Okay, so you're a Notre Dame fan. Here's the problem with Notre Dame, and I'm not hating a Notre Dame. I'm not trying to, you know, make you mad at me. Why does Notre Dame think they're too good for everybody else? Like, they won't join a conference. They're like, no, we're Notre Dame, so we're just going to do our own thing. Now, I know there's like a financial aspect of it. They just want to have control, do whatever they want to do. But like, it does have an air of, we are better than you guys and we're not joining any conference. We're just going to be like our own thing. I mean, that's the only thing only beef I got with Notre Dame, but whatever. Whatever. I'll get off my soapbox now. He says, all I can say about the Tide versus Dogs is Bryce Young. Yeah, he's good, man. Bryce is that's the Crimson's quarterback, right? Yeah, I mean, he's better than our quarterback, but you know, Georgia defense, man, we got some big boys. We're going. Oh, Bryce better get rid of that ball quickly. We're gonna be pushing folks around a lot in this game if we show up and play for all four quarters. So we'll see. Either way, it's gonna be a great game. I'm glad, regardless of who wins, that it's the SEC in the national championship. Regardless who wins, you know, the SEC wins, which is always cool. But I prefer if it's Georgia. I really would. I really, really would. All right. Your Nightmare says, thank you. I learned so much from watching your videos this past year. Thank you for being a viewer. I appreciate that, Your Nightmare. Thanks so much for the support. I really, really do appreciate it. And guys, I think that's our last comment for the evening. So guys, thanks for watching. As always, you know, pray for Georgia this Monday. Even if you're an Alabama fan, be nice. You know, let us win this one. Let's hope that they can get it done. The Golf Course Lawn Academy is live. So if you're looking for a direct way, a structured way to learn a whole lot about grass and soil and how to take your lawn from ordinary to extraordinary in the course of 3 months, that it was the same program we tested on my neighbor Alex's lawn. Check out the Golf Course Lawn Academy. It's a one-time purchase, gets you access to the Facebook group and priority access if you ever have to email. There's also channel memberships, which have different tiers from tier one all the way up to level 5. So depending on what your budget is like and how much you like me and like the channel and want to support, there's always that. And if even if you don't do any of those things, you guys can always leave a like on your way out at the end of the evening. So I really, really do appreciate you guys. Thank you guys so much for watching. I'm trying to see if I have any last little questions here. So Andrew says, what's your primary mower, the True Cut or the Greens mower? The Greens mower, by far. The True Cut really only comes out just to cut like the swale area, a few key spots in the lawn that I can't get with the Greens mower. Like I use, like literally the Greens mower gets, I know for every hour of cutting the Greens mower gets, the True Cut gets like less than 10 minutes because I'm only using it just for certain key areas of the lawn that I just can't get really well with the Greens mower, if that makes sense. So great question. And to close it out for tonight, Ken Shays in the house saying, go Dawgs. On that note, we will end. You guys see, I am sporting sort of like, you know, red and black a little bit. It's not like Georgia colors. So yeah, guys, pray for Georgia. Hopefully we can get it done this Monday. And yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. I truly do appreciate all the support. With the temp starting to rise here, you know, the content will begin to pick up, which is always cool. Thanks again for the show sponsor tonight, Mr. Josh Abib, coming in with the big super chat. If you guys want to be a sponsor of the channel or of the show next week, the way it works is pretty simple. Whoever has the largest super chat, that has the honor of you get your name in lights. If that's the thing, if that's your thing, you want to have your name in lights, there you go. That's one way to do it, is to just you know, support the channel via super chats. And Josh has that for this week, has the honor for this week. Thanks again to you guys. Be safe out there. You know, there's lots of stuff going on in the world, so be safe. Wash your hands. Don't kiss strange people. Get out and mow your lawn. Put some essential G down. Do all the fun stuff you can do now to get an amazing lawn in the spring.